We will call a meeting to order. This is the February 1st meeting of the Yellow Springs Village Council. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes.
Wintrow.
Here.
Hausch.
Here.
Sims.
Here.
McQueen.
Here.
Kemplin.
Here.
Also present are Village Solicitor Chris Connor, Supervisor of Electric and Water Distribution Johnny Burns, Assistant Village Manager Melissa Van Zandt, and Village Manager Penny Bates. And a great group of students from Ms. Morgan's class that we will be hearing from in just a little while. We're very pleased to have them here. Announcements. First, we'll have announcements. Any announcements?
Yes, I have one. As everybody's aware, February is Black History Month. And I don't know if everybody's aware, but we do have a Federal National Park here in our area, out in Wilberforce, and it is ran by the Park Service. And there's a monument building out there. It's the Charles Young Buffalo Soldiers National Monument. And it's out on 42 out in Wilberforce, and has been designated as a national park run by the Park Service. And each one of you council members, I gave you a package from the Park Service. Look at it at your leisure. But it's not that often that you have a national park close to you. So I encourage the village, I see we have a lot of young people there, to in your spare time over the summer, go out and visit.
Jerry, can you tell us about the name, the significance of the name?
Charles Young was part of the Buffalo Soldiers. And the Buffalo Soldiers, ironic and somewhat surprising to me, they were chartered to protect our national parks. And so that was their service. And years ago, it was a dangerous job. Because at that time, most of our national parks were forests, wilderness. And one of the tasks that the Buffalo Soldiers had was to protect the wood, the trees, from poachers and so forth. Back then, trees were valuable and people were constantly cutting them down. So that was their major job, protecting our forests. Imagine you can see some of the results of it now. You know, we have some beautiful natural forests, and they were responsible. And they were a all-black unit.
And I would also like to point out that the 2016 is the 100th year celebration of the National Park Service. So there will actually be a lot of special events in the national parks this year.
So I have an announcement. Sorry.
I just want to add a little bit, just reading from this about the Buffalo Soldiers. It says, American Indians called the Black Cavalry troops Buffalo Soldiers because their dark curly hair resembled a buffalo's mane, and because they fought with fierce bravery and a fighting spirit similar to that of the buffalo. African American troops accepted the name with pride and honor.
Very cool.
Yeah. Judith, could you adjust your microphone?
Oh, sure.
So along the lines of Black History Month, I also wanted to let everybody know that the 365 Project is going to host 4 movies in February. They're going to be Saturdays in the matinee time, 1 o'clock or 11 o'clock. So the first one starts this Saturday, and I am very excited that that's happening. I also wanted to give a shout out because February 1st is Township Day. And I wanted to say to our Miami Township trustees that we like collaborating with them and how great that is. And finally, I pulled out my Bulldog Blue today because I have a lot of pride in Yellow Springs schools, and I love seeing what project-based learning does, and I'm super impressed with Ms. Morgan's class. We're so happy to have you guys here.
I have a couple announcements. Last week, we had a meeting
of key stakeholders in the village about drug abuse issues in the village. There were probably about a dozen people, some people from the village government, Antioch College, the public schools, TCN, and Catherine Hitchcock from the Human Relations Commission and I are in the process of drafting a report, and we'll be bringing that to the Human Relations Commission this week, and we'll be coming back to council with a report about that. Also, I've, at the request of a citizen, begun investigating the possibility of having Yellow Springs develop an Indigenous Peoples Day. And we've talked about it at HRC, and HRC, which is the Human Relations Commission, decided that we should speak to some Indigenous people first. So there happened to be an article in the Yellow Springs News about Raymond Ruka, who is a Maori elder, and a woman who teaches at Antioch Midwest, who's Hawaiian. So I've met with them, had a very interesting conversation with them. And I'm just saying this now, both so council can just be alerted to this possibility, but also if there are people in the community who know their Indigenous roots and or have some ideas about how we might go about doing this, I wanted to let people know that we will be looking at this. The Environmental Commission is interested in it, as well as HRC.
Great, thanks. I would like to welcome Julie McGowan and David Benning and their family to the newest house on Cemetery Street. They had their open house on Friday. And there was actually an announcement, I'm hoping somebody might remember the name of the next family. So there will soon be groundbreaking for another house on Cemetery Street. And this is the project that the village has partnered with Home Inc. on. So we're really pleased to see, and there are lots of children coming, a new family bringing four children, current family has about four, so it's really exciting to see that development grow. And most importantly, I would like to announce that it is Brian Hausch's birthday tomorrow. So, next on the agenda is the consent agenda. We have the minutes of January 19th, 2016 regular meeting. Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Next are petitions and communications. Brian, could you review those, please?
Yes. So first of all, we got a from Ellis Jacobs, a research article about issues related to water quality specific to Flint, Michigan. And the upshot of that article, a very good one to read, is that the cause of the lead in the system is due to the aging of the pipes, and that is something I think we're going to be talking about at some point. Karen Wintrow provided an article about social media and website policy, which is important for something we're going to talk about later today with our own village Facebook page. Next, we Alice Robrich provided us with a New York Times article about the importance of treatment for drug addicts versus incarceration, very much in line with the meetings that Mary Ann and Catherine are leading. Henry Myers had a couple comments about goals. He wanted us to think about income tax and improving that process. And what was the other thing? Oh, about the sewer lines. No, I meant Henry Myers also talked about the sewer lines. Nancy Mellon included a thank you for supporting the People's Choice Award for the Arts Council member show. And finally, Kate Hamilton, well actually the Hamilton family, thanked Officer Frazier and the Miami Township Fire and Rescue Team for their professionalism and their fast action.
Very good. Let's talk about the review the agenda for a second. I would like to suggest that we actually move this around a little bit. Let's, the 2016-6, let's read that one first so the students can get a little bit of a feeling for what our normal course of business is, then read 2016-4, their resolution, and then we'll do the rules and procedures last in case we have, that may require a little bit more discussion on our part. So does that sound good or, okay.
And then we also have some commission nominations to add, I guess, under new business.
Oh yeah, that will, we'll put that under new business, okay. Okay, first we have Resolution 2016-06, authorizing dues for the Miami Valley Regional Planning Commission membership. Since I just read the title, I don't know that, Judy, do you want to read it in by title again?
Certainly, this is authorizing dues for the Miami Valley Regional Planning Commission.
Okay, so the dues for MVRPC are, oh, can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Dues this year, $1,604.02, and that's related to census, right? Is it census number?
It's based on population, yeah.
We've been in MVRPC for years. I've been the representative for the past 10 years, and I think it's one of the best ways that we can collaborate regionally, learn what's happening in around the entire region, and actually have some involvement in what the outcome is. We have a vote just like all of the other members, and we have discussion, and so we are able to have some influence on how things go. So I am in support of this.
And I'm also excited about things that MVRPC does, like the regional bike plan. This is the organization that does regional planning. There are several in the state, and I think they're doing a lot of great work that benefits Yellow Springs.
Great. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
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 Next we have Resolution 2006-04. Judy, would you please read that in full, please?
Yes, this is Resolution 2016-04, agreeing to strongly consider recommendations from Ms. Morgan's third grade class based upon their educational research. Whereas the students of Ms. Morgan's third grade class, Mills Lawn School, Yellow Springs, Ohio, have recently engaged in extensive research on local government, including in-depth interviews of public officials and village staff, and whereas in the course of their investigation, these students came to recognize their own value as participants in local government, and whereas Council recognizes that village students may have advice to offer on topics that affect young people living in Yellow Springs, Ohio, and whereas student representatives may serve to create a natural interaction between village council and village schools, and whereas local government needs involvement from many citizens with differing perspectives, now therefore the Council for the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio hereby resolves that Section 1, Village Council hereby agrees to consider consulting with student representatives from village schools on a regular basis. Section 2, Council will consider the inclusion of representatives between the ages of 8 and 17 to the greatest extent permitted by our charter.
Thank you. Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
This is, I can say myself how much I enjoyed working on this project and being interviewed by the students, lots of great questions. And what I thought was so interesting about it was that it wasn't just the elected officials, they talked to staff, so they real and citizens. So they got a very well-rounded view of what actually happens in local government, what we do, and how people like Patty and Melissa and Judy make it actually happen. So it was great, and the questions and the interview was fun too.
Were you going to say something, Mary?
Yeah, I just wanted to add that I was impressed with how thorough you guys all were, talking to so many different folks, asking so many questions, and I'm sure some of it got a little bit boring, but you guys didn't sound like it seemed like that, so I see some yeses and nos. I'll tell you, it was very neat for us to see the interest that you guys have in your local government decision making.
So,
I just wanted to thank you for including the staff. We really appreciate it. I mean, I know that I really enjoyed coming to speak with you guys and some of the questions that you asked me, and I'm glad that you took to heart my you can participate in your local government, because that's very important. And I think Melissa and Judy probably also enjoyed her.
It was a lot of fun. I was glad to see a lot of you guys outside your Zimba, so that was cool.
Yeah, I see Chief Hale was over there hiding in the corner. I think he participated as well.
So do we have any comments from citizens?
Did you go up to the microphone?
Well, I think we're going to pass it.
We're going to pass it, yeah.
And so state your name, and you have, and direct your comments here, and just tell us who you are.
I'm Claire, and we think council should support our resolution because our ideas and talents are useful.
My name is Lily, and consulting young people about village business would encourage young people's voice and choice in local government.
My name is Ayla. Kids also have ideas that will affect the other kids that live in town.
Council should support our resolution because young people are citizens, and citizens need to be involved in council.
And can you state your name, please?
I'm Sam.
Thank you, Sam.
Sam Gill.
Can you state your name?
Yeah. I'm Katie, and I think council should support our resolution because it would be nice to have young minds inform council business.
My name is Miles, and council should support our resolution because kids have different perspectives about problems.
Thank you all. Those were all very good suggestions and recommendations, and we liked hearing from you. Are we ready to take a vote, council?
I just wanted to say that this is really a great project, because what a lot of it's about is about empowerment of you as citizens of our village and citizens of our country, citizens of the world. And so you're becoming powerful people, speaking for what you think, and working together. And so I think this is a really great way to start becoming active citizens in the village. So, excellent.
And actually, maybe I'll add one more thing. So this is a great resolution, and to me, the next steps are to think about ideas to actually make it happen, right? So what could be some specific ways that you could participate that would make sense? And I think we would all be open and like to talk about that. So keep thinking about creative ideas.
And you're welcome in our meetings anytime, first and third Mondays at 7 o'clock.
And I'd like to say one thing. I just took a picture of all of you. So when I'm laying back in my recliner 10 years from now, I'm going to see if I recognize one of you up here sitting on the council podium.
That would be great. Wow, there's a challenge for you guys.
Yeah. So let's call the vote. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
And we actually have a framed resolution for you for your classroom.
There you go, thank you. Thank you all.
You're welcome to stay as long as you want. We're going on with more business. Doesn't get any more interesting than here.
Everybody wants to run for council now.
Sorry, lady.
Oh, you're fine.
It's on my
Finally, we have resolution 2016-5. We'll just read that in by title only.
Yeah, this is adopting rules and procedures for council.
Can I get a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. So I think we made some minor modifications from the last time. One change was that Brian asked for kind of a pre-meeting statement, a little bit more process for citizen comments to be included. I think that was done, was that under citizen participation, Judy?
You know, that I think the end, if I'm not incorrect, the end result of that was we added maybe one little
right. Oh, the, about cell phones, because most of it was already
it was there.
So, any other comments or questions or changes?
I have a question.
Sure.
Because it's an issue that came up in a commission. So, and it's under the attachment one, ethics, compensation.
Mm-hmm.
As I am reading this, and this is so this is a question, it would seem if there's a person on a commission who is, that the commission needs work and they're going to pay someone, it seems to me that this would allow a commission member to, you know, if it's their field, for them to be paid for work that someone else would be paid for. And the reason why I'm saying that is because under C, it seems to say that it does not include commissions, and then it goes on, that are advisory, that do not spend more than $10,000 on review. So, I mean, I don't think it should. I don't think we should be compensating commission members for work, whether they're so specialty or not. Well, you know, actually, you don't, I mean, we can vote for this, but it just did raise, it was a question that got raised, and then when I was reading this, I was
I think, actually, we discussed this earlier today. I'm not sure it was in the same vein that you're talking about, but I think it's always been my understanding that a commission or committee member should not be paid, you know, because they're serving the village in that capacity. I mean, I understand what you're saying is if it's their expertise and we're going to pay someone anyway, but I've just always been of that opinion. Chris, I don't know if you...
Well, our ordinances, regardless of this, our ordinances have that section
that
in each commission, yes.
That says you cannot be paid. So...
Which part were you looking at?
I think she's looking at A, where it says compensation.
Attachment A.
Right, I'm looking up. Okay.
Under A and C.
Chris, did you want to...
I think Brian answered it.
Yeah, I think it's... Okay. Any other comments or questions?
I just wondered if we should, you know, there's the 3-minute minimum that we usually give citizens to comment.
Mm-hmm. I thought that was... Mm-hmm.
But I wondered, I mean, sometimes someone's saying something that we actually want to hear more than 3 minutes from, does that preclude us saying, we'd like to give you extra time?
Okay. No, Karen has done that in the past.
I mean, I think that it's... the presiding officer may terminate continued discussion at any point. Well, that doesn't... let's see. I thought that there was...
I did, too.
I mean, that's Robert's rules that you can extend.
Right.
That is a Robert's rules.
And I think since Robert's rules is shown, is indicated as the guideline,
didn't want us to feel like we couldn't.
Right.
Well,
yeah.
It is should be and not shall be. And it does leave the presiding officer some... That seems to leave the presiding officer some leeway.
I would agree with that.
Yeah, it also says guidelines, so maybe that's a...
Okay, that's fine, yeah.
Anything else? Ready to call the vote? All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay. Citizen concerns. Now is the time in the agenda for items for citizens to comment on items that are not on the agenda. You do have 3 minutes. We ask that you come to the podium and state your name. Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to council table. Next, we have a special report from John Courtney, our electric rate consultant. We have a little
we're switching
electronic.
Yeah, we're switching computers.
Going on. Okay.
All right.
Tonight. And for those of you that maybe have not been here when Scott was here with me, Scott Wigging, my associates, here with me as well tonight. So let me just kind of start off on the next slide of the presentation. You hired us to do a electric rate and cost of service study. It's been a while ago now. It's kind of been an ongoing process. But as a part of that study, the scope of services included, first off, a revenue requirement analysis where we looked at we projected revenues at current rates and compared it to projected operating expenses and capital costs. We then also prepared a cost of service analysis where we allocated those revenue requirements to the various customer classes, and I've got some slides to give you some detail on that. And then we took a look at your existing rates, and we made that presentation of those three components of the study last year. And since then, we've actually met a couple times with the Energy Board and talked about some of the rate design issues. I think they made a report to you last month, maybe, or a month before. Been a couple months, maybe.
It was a while back.
Yeah, and then as a follow-up to that, we've developed new rates, and that's what we're really here tonight to talk about. But just to kind of refresh your memory with regard to the results of the revenue requirement analysis, as this slide indicates on slide three, that we had projected a shortfall between revenues and current rates and revenue requirement of about 9%. And had recommended that basically that you would need to increase your overall your revenues by roughly 9% in order to meet those projected revenue requirements. As I said earlier, then we took those revenue requirements and we allocated them to the various customer classes. And you can see the breakdown there. We identified four rate classes: residential, commercial, single phase. That's what the one my circle with the slash. Single-phase customers, commercial three-phase customers, and then large power, which are would be your larger commercial or industrial-type customers. And what the results indicated to us were that while we needed an overall revenue increase of roughly 9%, it said that the residential class really needed to go up by almost 13%, 12.7 is the figure that the study showed there at the top. The commercial single-phase needed to go up about 29%. Commercial three-phase about 12%, and the large power actually showed that it was over-recovered, which could justify a reduction in revenues from the large power. Hopefully, you have a graph here that kind of puts this into a picture. But you can see that with the relative line, overall being 9%, you can see that residential, commercial single-phase, commercial three-phase were all above the overall increase of 9.2%, while obviously the large power with a reduction was below that. So basically the conclusions on the cost of service analysis were that it would indicate that the large power classes, in essence, subsidizing the residential and the commercial classes. And we recommended that future rate adjustments should try to move more towards the cost of service results. And I think I explained when I was here last at council that that's always kind of a moving target, and we could update this study a couple years from now and the results might look a little different. They wouldn't look drastically different, but they would look a little different. So you never really achieve full cost of service, but you at least want to make movement in that direction whenever you make a change in your rates. In essence, where we were at that point, the next step then was to review your current rates. I didn't stick all of those rates back in this presentation for the interest of time. But basically what we found in taking a look at your rates, we found that the customer charges were below what we consider to be customer-related costs. When I say customer charges, you really don't have a specific customer charge in any of your electric rates. You have some minimum charges.
And those minimums happen to include a certain amount of usage, but they also, which would exceed what the charge would be for that usage. And so, so in essence, we are collecting some fixed cost through that minimum charge, but not really in the sense of a true customer charge that we would typically recommend. We also found that your commercial rates weren't tracking with the cost of service, in the sense that because your commercial rates do not include a demand charge, a demand component. And even though we had a slide back in the presentation previously that showed where better than probably two-thirds almost of your cost is demand-related, and yet you recover that on an energy basis. And so that's not, doesn't result in a good tracking between cost and revenues. We also found that your high load factor, large power customers, in essence, we're subsidizing the lower load factor. High load factor customers are customers who run two or three shifts of operation versus, say, a single shift of operation. So they use a lot more energy relative to their peak demand. Because of the way your rate, your large power rate, which does have a demand, it's well below the cost of service for demand, yeah.
I'd just like to stop for just a second and see if anybody has any questions so far, because I know this is a lot of information to digest.
I have a question. You're using the term customer charge. Are you using the term customer charges and demand charges?
Those are separate. Customer charge would be a fixed charge that the customer pays regardless of the amount of energy they use or regardless of what their peak demand is. So it's a component of charge in the rate that really is designed to recover what we call customer-related costs. And those are predominantly things related to meter reading, billing, and collection. That's a portion of it. But it's also a portion of maintenance and upkeep and investment in the distribution system, because you have to build a certain amount of facilities and maintain those just to get to a customer regardless of what they use. So
it's like having the infrastructure as well as all of the people that service it and do all the work.
Yeah, sometimes I know, Patty, I think Pat last time referred to it as a readiness to serve type charge. That's similar to
service. Yeah, and Marianne, you can kind of think of it as operating costs. When you look at the budget, operating costs.
It doesn't relate to how much energy they use or what their load is. So it's basically just to have service available at their facility. And again, that doesn't necessarily recover all of that cost, but it at least covers that that's related to customer, serving an individual customer. It doesn't recover the demand-related costs of the system as well. You know, things like having to size wires big enough to handle a certain amount of load going through them. So, the last thing I pulled up there with regard to the rate review was we found, too, that you were using a 12-month rolling average to calculate your power supply cost adjustment that you see on your bill every month. And we had recommended that you change that to a shorter period, and you did that. And in fact, that addressed, if you remember the one slide back earlier that showed a pretty big shortfall in 2015, that was related to this situation, the rolling 12-month, and you've shortened that now to a 3-month average. You did that last year, and we've kind of fixed that issue with regard to the rates. So in summary, where we were at when we were here last was that the revenues and current rates are not sufficient to meet the projected revenue requirements, that the large power class is subsidizing the residential and commercial classes, and that the customer charges are well below what we consider to be customer-related costs. There are some others, obviously, with regard to demand rates needing to be higher with regard to the commercial rates. So, but these were kind of the key summary points that we made when we were here last. So with that, and by the way, if anybody has any questions, just feel free to stop me. Our recommendations, as we basically were to, in, you know, to modify that power supply cost adjustment to make it on a 3-month rolling versus a 12-month rolling basis, was to increase the customer charges, again, get them more in line with cost of service, develop commercial rates that would include both a demand and an energy component in the rate, and you'll see we've done that for you, and also to move the large power demand charge more towards the cost of service, in other words, increase it from its current level to a higher level, and that actually ends up getting offset by a reduction in the energy charge, as you'll see. And again, the last one was is to roll part of your power supply cost adjustment into the base rates, because that's becoming a bigger part of the bill and really needs to get reflected through the base rates as opposed to through the adjustment each month. So I just have to hold that up in the air for you to get to. So let me get to what we're here tonight to talk about, and that's the proposed electric rates. As I said before, we've met twice with the Energy Board, had some fairly lengthy discussions about some of the, some of the ideas of different rate designs and how they would impact customers. And again, I think you received a memo from the Energy Board that kind of outlined the, what they recommended your goals be with regard to the rate changes. So.
They came before council.
So it, basically, in conjunction with their recommendations, again, the goals as we identified in them were to increase the overall revenues by approximately 9% so that we meet those revenue requirements, and that we move the revenue distribution towards the cost of service. Now, not necessarily getting all the way there, but one example is, rather than reducing the large power revenue, was to basically take what would have been a reduction and use that to offset some of the increase for the commercial three-phase or single-phase customer class, so that it's not looking at a 30% increase. And so that we try to balance some of that out. But the third bullet there is to replace the minimum charge with a true customer charge. Fourth bullet is to implement the demand charge for the the smaller and medium-sized customers in your commercial rate. And then also to increase the demand charge for your large power customers, and then lastly, to roll part of your power supply cost into your base rate. So with that, let me kind of walk you through the proposed rates. And one of the things that we talked to the Energy Board, and again, I think was part of the recommendation, was to also eliminate the energy blocks. You currently have in your rates what we call declining energy blocks. So the more power you use, you get a lower rate. You pay a lower price per kilowatt hour. And the sense was that we wanted to eliminate that and replace it with a flat energy charge. And that's what you're going to see in these rates that we're proposing for you tonight. So the new residential rate would have a customer charge. And then again, this is a charge that every customer would pay, regardless of how much energy they use, of $10 per month. Now that charge then would also increase over the next 5 years at $1 each year. So the intent would be to ultimately get to $15, which is where the cost of service says it really needs to move to, but we're trying to phase that in over 5 years. So to try to mitigate the impact of overnight going to a $15 customer charge, what we're recommending is to implement it initially at $10 and then phase it in $1 per year increase over a 5 year period. The energy charge you can see is 11 cents per kilowatt hour. Again, that would be a flat rate. You would still have a power supply cost adjustment, but it would start out at or actually probably slightly below zero, probably a negative initially given where your power costs are today. But it was designed on where we saw or where the projections were for power costs for 2017 to be zero. So you already have a kilowatt hour tax component as well in your rates, and we certainly would recommend that you continue to maintain the kilowatt hour tax component as well. So that's what the residential rate would look like under the new format. The commercial rate actually currently has one customer charge, regardless of whether you're single phase or three phase. What we're recommending is that we have a separate customer charge for single and three phase. But again, initially, it would start at they would both start at $15. That's where the minimum is for the commercial rate today. But as footnotes 1 and 2 indicate, the single phase charge would increase, like residential, by $1 per year over the next 5 years. So it would end up at $20. The three phase, on the other hand, would increase at $2 per year and get to $25, which is where the cost of service indicates it should be. So basically, we're trying to mitigate that impact at the front end by setting both those customer charges equal to the minimum. But then we'll increase those, and the three phase will go up at a quicker rate than the single phase to get to where it needs to be. Like the residential, it'd have a flat energy charge of 11.5 cents, a little bit higher than the residential, which is typically what cost of service indicates. Again, you have a power cost adjustment kilowatt hour tax, the same as you currently do in the rates. So, and then the last, we'd have the general service rate. At this rate, the commercial rate, what we're suggesting, because it would not include a demand component, would only be available to existing customers, as the footnote says. The idea here is to grandfather at least of all customers that are currently not billed demand, and that's virtually all your commercial customers, to stay on a non-demand rate, at least for now. But all new customers, any new customer, or anybody who would move into an existing facility as a new customer, would move to the general service rate. So this rate, this commercial rate that I just read to you a little bit ago, that would only be available to existing customers as of the effective date of the rate. Any new customer that comes along would have to go to the general service rate which is going to include both a demand and an energy component. Has the same customer charge as the commercial, the $15 starting out for both single and three-phase, you know, the dollar and the $2 escalations on that for 5 years. But instead of the energy charge of 11.5 cents, we now have a demand charge of $10 per kilowatt, and that would be per kilowatt of peak demand, the highest rate at which the customer uses power within the month over a 30-minute period. And we'd have a flat energy charge of 7 cents, so a higher demand offset by a lower energy charge. And if customers, existing customers, find that they would be pay a lower rate under this rate, they would have the option to go to this rate. But once they would do that, they would not be able to go back to the commercial rate. I mean, we grandfather rate. Typically, what we're trying to do is close it out. We're trying to eventually end up with everybody on the general service rate. So any customer, any existing customer who chooses to be on general service because they would pay less under the general service, would then have to stay on general service going forward.
And that was what I was going to say, that there is the potential that someone would actually pay less.
Absolutely.
On the general service rate.
Absolutely.
And so we had discussed letting them have that option, existing customers have that option.
Yes, in fact, you'll have what we call higher load factor customers, and again, those are going to be customers that typically use a lot of energy around the clock. Anybody that has refrigeration equipment, grocery stores, convenience stores, things of that type, or any of the, possibly some of the restaurants downtown that, have refrigeration runs all night long, may find that they'd be better off on the general service rate than they would be on the commercial rate.
So this isn't considered a disincentive to businesses moving to Yellow Springs or expanding out of their existing spaces?
No, because actually I think that the first thing to know is that anybody that is out there currently has the option to stay
on the commercial rate.
On the commercial rate.
But not if they move into a new location.
If they're still a customer.
That would be your choice. Normally we would require, if they move to a new location, it would be a new customer. They would
fall. Yeah, I was asking, it would be starting service at another location. Yeah.
But it could conceivably, I mean, this, I think it's going to be half and half, that some people will work out better for,
It may even be more than half and half. I mean, we took a look at some of the customer data you gave us, and we know there are going to be a number of customers that are going to want to be on the general service rate. We kind of designed it intentionally that way so that, we try to move customers and migrate them off of the commercial rate. The idea eventually is those customers leave town or are no longer customers, then eventually we get down to maybe a handful of customers and then we can eliminate that rate at some point in the future. So
I mean, it's hard for me to we're talking kind of we don't know who we're talking about. I mean, I'd love to, and I don't want you to talk about specific customers or Johnny or anybody to talk about, but it's hard for me to understand, who is going to be impacted and how they're going to be impacted. And this is going to be a lot for the business community to understand. And so that, it's a lot, it's going to be a lot, I mean, especially if they have major decisions to make.
Right, and we understand that, and that's why I think one of the reasons I think Rick is here is to speak to the consideration that we did give to some of the businesses, potentially not only the existing businesses but the new businesses coming in. And this rate is actually more equitable for some of the not the large users, because we were all supporting them anyway, but for the commercial rate users.
You've got situations. We have commercial customers that are high load factor, just like in large power, that are subsidizing the the smaller, poor load factor customers. So this gives those customers the ability to, benefit from their load factor, pay a lower rate than they would if they were on the non-demand rate, the commercial rate.
So. Right. One of the reasons that the Energy Board chose to recommend the flat rate to the council to have John work out the structure was because it is the most equitable rate for everyone across the board.
Well, let me go to the large power rate. and this really isn't a change in structure. This rate is already basically this structure, except with the exception of the customer charge. And what we're proposing is that you have a $50 per month customer charge. Now, keep in mind, this isn't a large group of customers. These are all larger customers, typically demands in the 100 kW or larger category. I think you've got about 14 or 15 of them on this rate now. There's a couple there we may have to take a look at and see whether they would be better off staying on general service or not. versus being on this rate. But they're already made a demand charge. It's $5.60, I believe, which is now going to $10. And the energy charge that they're paying is going to actually reduce. They're paying, I think it's 3.9 cents plus your power cost adder. And so they'll actually see a reduction in their energy charge and increase in their demand. And again, this is trying to get the rate more in line with the cost of service so that the higher load factor customers aren't subsidizing the lower load factor customers. So, and again, we may have some lower load factor customers in there that we may have to allow to go to the general service rate to mitigate that a little bit for them. But we'll just have to get, you know, we'll take a look at those dozen or so customers and see where they fall out best. I can tell you, we looked at some of the data from last, when we started the study, and it looks to us like other than maybe one or two of them, they're going to save money actually on this large power rate, a slight amount over what they were paying under the old rate. So, and then this last slide gives you basically an idea of how the bills will compare. Now, keep in mind this reflects a power supply cost adjustment of 3.85 cents, which is not where your power cost adjustment is today. It's well below that. So this is based on 2017 projected power costs, so you want to keep that in mind. But relative to each other, when your power cost adder today would be 3.85 cents, the power cost adder under the new rates would be zero. That would be the equivalent power cost adder. So you can see for a 1,000 kilowatt hour bill, residential there on line two, the bill would be $111.15, and it would increase to $124.65. It's about a $13 increase, $13.50. And the target increase for the residential class was right at 13%. So that comes out real close to what we tried to target for the residential class. You can see the other increases for a commercial single and three phase, and those are also in roughly about that same range. Now, for the large power, again, we try to design that rate to be revenue neutral. Now, when I do that, though, that means some people are going to see a reduction and some are going to see an increase. There's just no way of getting around that as we move towards cost of service. But for these sample bills, you can see that we actually were reflecting a slight reduction. For the 500 kilowatt customer with 150,000 kilowatt hours a month, that bill would go from 15,429 roughly to 15,350. So try to keep it about as revenue neutral as we could, but still trying to raise that customer charge more in line with cost of service. By the way, the $10 customer charge is about half of what we could cost justify. So we haven't gotten all the way there. You can justify almost a $20 demand charge, but if we were to do that, then you'd see some low load factor customers, getting impacted very negatively. And so we tried to mitigate that, this being one step towards cost of service results. And the next time you address rates again, hopefully not 9 years, it's been 9 years since your current rates were put in place, but if it's 5 or 6 years out, then we can try to address that again and get that that demand charge a little higher and reduce that energy a little more. So, but I think that gets me to the last slide. So,
I have a question. I emailed you this question, but I think that council needs to know the answer to it is, part of my manager's report tonight addresses the fact that the hydros are going online. Some of them are already online. Some of them will be online by the end of February. And I believe all of them are projected to be online. The last one's October, Johnny, someplace?
All but one.
All but one before October, though, right? Like, in short order. So we know that there's going to be a substantial rate increase coming with that. Has that been factored into these?
Well, the effect of your power cost going up as a result of the hydros will happen under your current rates and your proposed rates.
Correct.
So that's kind of a wash between the two rates. I mean, that doesn't your power cost adjustment that you have would automatically go up as those costs, as you incur those higher costs for the hydro, mm-hmm. and that's still going to be the same under the proposed rate. So that didn't really change. The increase in revenue that's generated here is not affected by power costs. It's basically to cover non-power supply costs.
So the increase that we're going to see from hydro will be strictly through the power cost.
The power cost adjustment. That's
and
correct.
So I just want council to be clear that they don't have to increase rates
when that happens. That's correct.
If your bill is going to go up,
right?
Because it just is, but we won't need to increase rates. It will happen automatically through the power cost adjustment that is on your bill every month.
Do we, I wish we would have brought a sample bill. I mean, we're talking about all these different numbers and these different rates. I wish, do we have a sample bill anywhere?
They're not actually broken down on the bill. The bill will have the read dates and the number of kilowatt hours that were read on the meter. The power cost adjustment, the kilowatt hour tax, all those other things are folded in. I think the kilowatt hour tax is folded in. I don't think that it's outlined separately. So basically, there's just one line for electric, even though it's much more complicated than that, what goes into the actual rate. That's why it's very hard to try to recalculate. It's very easy with water because it's very straightforward, but electric is just much more complex because we have our rate, and then there's that power cost adjustment that gets folded in that compensates for as rates fluctuate from where we buy our power, such as the hydros. So it's not broken down on a bill.
Is it possible to provide more information?
I don't know.
Or more of a breakdown? What do most communities do?
Probably about as many different ways as there are different communities. And some go to the extreme and show every piece of every charge. For example, where you have three energy blocks now, they would show each of those, which probably is a little bit of overkill. But at minimum, what we like to at least see is that the base rate charge is separated from the kilowatt hour tax and separated from the power cost adjustment, if it can be. So at least those break out, because those are kind of three separate components. And those can, as you all know, the power cost adjustment can change. So while the base rates stay the same or have been the same, for example, like say for the last 9 years, and typically don't change very often, the power cost adjustment changes every month. And so it really is best to break it out and the customer can see that charge and how it changes. Kilowatt hour tax hopefully doesn't change, but it can change, and not because you change it, but because the state legislature changes it. And so that charge, again, we typically see it, you know, sometimes broken out because it could be a moving component at some point in the future. But as I say, we've got clients who do what you do. And you get one line on the bill for electric, one line for water, one line for wastewater. Sometimes you just don't have enough lines to put everything on the bill. So it's really all over the place as to, you know, what people show on the bill.
But you like to see it, those three things?
We at least like to see that power cost adder separated because it moves, because it changes, and that way the customer can see that's not a part of the base rates. They're thinking, well, you did something to change the rates and my bill changed. Well, no, the power cost adder changed. Kilowatt hour tax, if it's in or separated, isn't as big a deal because it's not changed since it was implemented, so in 2001. But that's not to say the state legislature couldn't decide that they need more revenue and not raise the kilowatt hour tax. So the way you adopt it is you adopt it by reference to the high revised code. So when it changes, you don't have to take any action. It will automatically happen in your ordinance. It'll say, you know, it'll reference the section of the higher revised code that if it changes, then your rate will change. So.
And I did look up a copy of the bill because I have it on the utilities website to understand your utility bill. And it is just one line where it's just got the kilowatt hours for the usage and then the amount. So it doesn't have anything broken down.
So we would probably want to look into whether we could break it down in categories that John suggested.
Yeah, we can look at that.
John, in the context of this discussion then with the hydro going online, when we look at that next to last slide before the question mark, so existing versus proposed, that would change?
Well,
higher rates,
the power cost adder adjustment will be what it needs to be to cover power costs. When we did the study back last spring, and we projected your power supply cost adjustment under your current rates, that's where that 3.85 cents comes from. Because for 2017, based on what AMP was telling us your power cost would look like in 2017, that equates to, and we ran through the formula, the power cost adder formula, and that's what your power cost adjustment would be based on what they told us almost a year ago.
Okay.
Now, since then, and I don't think it's any secret, their power costs, their projection of costs for the hydro plants has increased.
Right.
And so you can anticipate that you're going to see probably a higher cost in 17, possibly, but there's a little offset to that. And that is, those projections they gave us back in earlier last year also assumed that you were going to pay the distribution charge from Dayton Power and Light that they had proposed at the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission. And if you remember, you were able to get them to roll that back. And so some of that increase from the hydro that was not in that number gets offset with the reduction that you're already seeing from the DP&L distribution charge being less than what AMP thought it was going to be. So it's a little bit offset. I've not seen recent updates for AMPs right now updating their projections with the latest hydro numbers. In fact, I just got an email this morning from one of the guys in planning at Power Supply Planning that said they'll be sending those to us probably next week or so. But again, bottom line is whatever power costs are is what they are, and your power cost adjustment will have to adjust to whatever they are. If they're lower than what AMP said, then your power cost adjustment will be lower than what it would need to be, and you'll end up with lower rates. You pass that on to the customers as well. So
could we revise the proposed?
Well, if we revise the I wouldn't revise the proposed rates at all. But again, they're synchronized with the power cost adjustment under your current rates. We're planning to roll in some of that in essence that 3.85. We're rolling that into these proposed base rates. So now instead of recovering that 3.85 cents through the power cost standard, you'll get it through the base charges that you saw, the $10, the 11 cents. You'll get it through the base rates, and then to the extent power costs are lower than we thought or higher than we thought, that'll be passed through the power cost adjustment. So you'll see that when these new rates go into effect, you'll likely see a negative power cost adjustment initially, assuming they go into effect in the next four or five months. But once your power costs get above that assumed base, then you're going to see a positive number. But it's going to be small. It's not going to be like 3 or 4 cents. That's why you have that power cost adjustment in your rates, because we can't sit here nobody can sit here and tell you for sure what you're going to pay for power next month or 6 months or 12 months from now. It's always a moving target. Your power costs are not based on a rate, they're based on cost. And you pay a proportionate share of cost of project costs, like the hydros, for example. We never know what those costs are going to be until we get there, unfortunately. You have estimates and projections, but the actual final cost you won't know until you finally get there.
For instance, the rate of increase that was projected for 15 actually ended up being half what it was because the hydros didn't go online.
Right.
So it was actually, instead of 28%, I just got the report late this afternoon that we actually paid 14.5%.
Yeah, and part of that was the DP&L distribution charge being less than what they originally projected. Yeah.
So we might as well finish with the hydros now. Some of the hydros are online. Willow Island is at least partially one or two units, maybe all three are online.
Two.
Okay, and then Hamilton will be on by the end of February, and Meldal is going into dry commissioning in March. Smithland will be a while yet. Is that correct, Johnny? How I remember the AMP.
And you get more from Meldal than you do from the other three projects.
So Meldal's supposed to go.
Meldal Greenup was rolling as well.
Right, they're supposed to go into dry commissioning in March, which means they'll probably by June be online, I think, is the projection.
And just to piggyback on the power cost adjustment, we do a very similar thing with our garbage cost as well. We have a fuel surcharge. So your tier may be $13 a month, but it could fluctuate. It could be $13.56 one month. It could be $13.42 another month. So we do the same thing with garbage, too.
I'm a little more confused because I have been hearing that once the hydros go online, we're going to have a significant, we're going to be paying more.
Yes.
And now, is that true?
More than you did in 2015, yes. More than you are today.
I think the important thing to remember is you will see the village's power cost go up. Each individual resident won't see this huge increase. We'll eventually, at the end of the day, have quite a bit of increase in our own personal residential bills. But it's the cost that the village pays per kilowatt hour megawatt hour is going to be much more than we currently pay.
I'm thinking of the customer at this point. The customer's costs are going to be going up.
Yes, our costs go up with the power cost, which is the hydro gets involved in that. As that power cost gets more expensive, depending on our source or how much the actual power costs, each month there's an amount that gets rolled into the bill on top of our base rate, and that's what fluctuates every month. So as these hydros come online, that power cost adjustment will get a little bit more because we're paying more for our power as those come on.
Once we get all the hydros online, what percentage of our electricity is going to be coming from them?
It's almost 60%.
I was gonna say 50.
More than half, I know. I don't have the exact number, but it's more than half of your energy will come from hydro.
So right now, 58 is sticking.
Right now, that energy that you'll be getting from hydro is coming from the market. So it's going to replace power that you're buying in the market basically as they come online. But it's, don't hold me to a specific percentage, but I'm certain that it's more than 50%. I believe it's maybe closer to 60.
It's 58 is sticking in my head.
It's a big number. Now the good news is, once that hydro does come online, and yes, you are going to see an increase, you know, in what customers pay because of that. Once all of those costs are now incorporated in and you're paying them, they're going to remain fairly stable for a long time because the hydro cost is about 90% debt service, and about 10% O&M. So that debt service doesn't change. I mean, it's going to basically be fixed for a long, long time. So you're not going to see future increases. You're going to see a bump as a result of, you know, the hydros coming online. But then you're going to see your rates remain, your power and supply costs at least remain fairly stable because the hydro is not going to continue. It's not going to increase at like 5% a year because it's mostly debt.
I think it's also important to note that the reason why previous council, I guess, agreed to the hydro is because we are lowering our carbon footprint.
That's correct. And these hydro projects will be certified for renewable energy credits. So they are certified as renewable energy sources. They were able to get that certification before they even started the projects to make sure that they would be. So.
Yeah, and I'm showing for the 2015 off the market, we were buying 62.8%.
Yeah.
And then the NYPA is 7.3% also.
Yeah.
New York Power Authority, which is hydro.
Yes, you'll still, I mean, you'll still have a little bit of power on the market. Yeah, that's right, and you still have the NYPA, which is also hydro as well. So.
Until it goes dry for maintenance.
Yeah, for 2 years. So does anyone have any other questions of John? I mean, this is the flat rate that council spoke about early last spring.
Last April, I think we were
John's been working on it.
I would like to something done as in by way of explanation that can be presented to the business community. I think they seem to be the most impacted in, as far as somewhat totally different rate structure and choices that they have to make. And I don't know that, I think that somebody's gonna have to walk them through it. So I'd like to understand how that's gonna happen. If it's Melissa, you know, exactly how they're gonna understand what choices they have to make and what impact it's going to have on them,
maybe,
on their bills.
Maybe we could have an informational session.
I think what we could maybe do is run some comparison bills, like previous and proposed, for a couple of different, you know, users. We could look at, a couple of different ranges of people. We could look at a smaller business, and we could look at, you know, the larger commercial one phase, three phase, large power, and we could kind of run it.
And you keep in mind, part of the reason why we needed to have this non-demand commercial rate, this grandfathered rate, is because you've got a lot of commercial customers that have not had a demand meter at their facility. So we don't know what their demands are, and they don't know what their demands are, and until the meters are all installed, you're not going to know. And so we had to have a rate that we could at least put these people on temporarily until we get data, until they've got data to look at, and you've got data to look at to determine, are they better off on general service? Now, some do. Some of those accounts already have demand, and you can utilize that data to determine which rate they would be best on, but some of them you don't even have demand data for. And so without that non-demand rate to go to, in the dark. So
I feel bad that there aren't any business representatives here hearing this, but I don't know that it would mean anything. I don't know that it would be meaningful to them because they're not really going to have any specifics of how it's going to impact them.
I think probably what Melissa's talking about, where you can pull a specific business's usage and then look at it and maybe sit down with them and have an informational session. Maybe we could talk John or Scott to come back and having a sit-down meeting so that it's a little bit...
And we've done that with other clients, especially where we've had a change, this type of change in structure, where we come in and allow them an opportunity to come and maybe do it, you know, one during the day and one in the evening. And then we show them sample bills and show them how the current rate works and how the new rate works. A lot of them probably don't even know how their bill's calculated now.
Most people really focus on water. Like we have to break down water bills on a daily basis for customers. We're rarely asked to break down an electric bill. I don't know if I've ever done it since I've been here, but I've done water bills on a daily basis.
Well, in terms of comparing the two options, isn't it just a formula? I mean, you know, if we have their data, can...
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah. And it may be, I mean, you're on software solutions, and it may be that it may be that you can run sample bills at new rates. I mean, sometimes they have that option where you can actually take historical data for a customer and you can run what his bill would look like with, you know, the new rates kind of plugged in before they take effect.
Right.
You know, to give them an idea of what's going to happen. But again, you got to remember, some of these customers we don't even have demand for. So to run, we wouldn't even know what to assume their demand to be, to run them on the general service rate, but we could run them on the commercial rate and, you know, the non-demand rate, at least give them an idea of what their bill would look like under the new rates versus what they are under the current rates.
But those new meters are coming.
Right.
So,
well, I guess
have them sometime.
I do have another question, and I know we've talked about this before, how difficult it is to compare, Yellow Springs versus, you know, another community based on all the different ways that these are covered, but is there some way to get a general idea of where we're at? And
We did a bill comparison for you when we were here last year, that presentation, if you go back and look, where we compared your current rates to DP&L's rates.
Mm-hmm.
And those DP&L rates that we did last year, make sure it was Scott, but I think for the most part, DP&L was higher than what all the proposed rates were under this bill comparison. So obviously you're closer to them than what you are, you know, under the proposed than you are today. But they were all competitive with DP&L at the proposed. And again, keep in mind, we're comparing DP&L today to where we think your cost will be in 2017 with the power cost adder. So it's not quite apples to apples, but I don't know how much their rate will change between, you know, DP&L's rate, for example, will change between now and 2017. But at least that comparison, if you go back and look, you'll find that those were all pretty competitive with DP&L.
I actually have a DP&L bill in my office that Denise did. It's probably a year old now, but she's a DP&L customer because she lives in the township, and she calculated her bill based on our rates and compared it to DP&L's, and it was like 30% more. So I've got the breakdown on her DP&L bill with the comparison of our rates to what DP&L's charges were for that particular bill. So that was really interesting to see that.
So DP&L is 30% more.
Higher than us.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And we're talking about roughly a 13% increase in your rates.
So Patty, what is your time frame for wanting an ordinance to come before council?
I'm going to let Melissa speak to that because I know that getting this rate in place is a concern for her based on some of the information. Do you have a particular...
I had built it into the budget as if it were going to be a full year's increase because I wasn't real sure when this was going to come up. So, but then again, though, I mean, this is a totally new rate structure, and this is, you know, much more than just changing the per kilowatt hour base charge. So I understand that with that complexity that's added to this flat rate structure, that it might take a little more consideration by council. And Thankfully, the electric fund at least has a little bit of wiggle room so that if my projections were a little off for the year, it wouldn't be damaging. So I think that we would be okay if council needed the extra time because of the complexity of the new rate structure.
I feel that this is complex enough and impactful enough that we need, you know, there's really nobody here. I mean, I know Rick is here more to support because he was involved with the Energy Board. I don't see citizens here to comment. I don't think we've been clear that there's going to be a rate increase. So I think we certainly need more time for public input. And I, you know, as I said, I would at least like to get something out to the business community to give them a heads up as to what to expect, and you know, maybe have staff strategize with what maybe the next step would be, might be to speak to them. I'm not necessarily saying we need to sit down with everybody, you know, but I'm thinking maybe March. I mean, maybe if we could do some research in February and have the ordinance come back in March. Mm-hmm.
I could work with John to maybe, because like he said, I mean, we don't have the demand for all of the businesses, so we could look at some of them and we could make some generalizations in terms of how certain users' bills may be impacted that do have demand for the information that we do have. But I know that's the thing, is that those meters for some of the commercial and the larger power customers, we've got a delay on them, so it would be nice if those would have came in with everybody else, but with all the residential meters, I mean, but they didn't. So we could look at some of the customers for which we do have the data for, and we could run some solid numbers based on those businesses, but we wouldn't be able to do it for all of them because we just don't have the information. But we could work together to try to run some comparisons for reference.
What we could do is, Melissa can do the comparisons. Perhaps we can have a public information session for the, you know, affected, potentially affected business owners and large use customers. And then if council wanted to, maybe during agenda planning, set a specific council meeting for discussion of it before we bring the ordinance, do you want to do that?
Probably we should discuss it again.
And so that way we'll know when the ordinance would be due. And. Mm-hmm. Does anyone have any other questions about the flat rates?
Well, in regard to the meters, is there any relationship to, say, getting the new meters before changing the rate?
We don't know when they're going to come in is the problem.
Oh, but that's the question. Should the rate for the commercial large use people wait until they have their new meters, or is there no relationship?
So, I mean, each customer would have, well, their demand could vary. And for each individual customer to get a real solid comparison for that particular customer, we would have to have that information for their business only. But there are a couple of customers in town that do have demand meters already that we could look at for comparison purposes. It's not going to be exact because each business could vary in terms of their demand. But we could at least try to make some generalizations with the data that we do have. Because even once the meters do come in and we put them in, we have to have data in order to be able to cross-reference. So that can take a while to build that up to get some solid numbers for those customers that we have nothing for.
And it's not going to be a problem to implement the new rates before the meters, because you've got the commercial rate, the non-demand commercial rate, that they all will go to if they don't have a demand meter. So. I mean, you're not going to put a person on a demand rate without a demand meter. So they have a place that they'll go to, and they'll be on that commercial rate. And then once you acquire enough data on their demand, then you can do the analysis for them and say, hey, it looks like you might save money. Or it may say, you're better off staying on the commercial non-demand rate. And you can stay there as long as you stay there. So they would have that option at that time. So.
And I think essentially what it comes down to is, if it were me, I would want to know if my bill was going to go up or down by how much. And a lot of the terminology can be really confusing even to people who deal with it every day. So yeah. I think...
Be careful about talking about going down. With the exception of a few large power customers, everybody's probably going to go up.
Right.
just so I don't give the impression that a lot of people are going to see reductions, but there are a few large power
customers. Nobody's going to see a reduction. Somebody might see a less...
Of an increase
if they go with a different system.
Yeah. But I think my point is, I think they're going to want to know more, how is my bill going to be affected, as opposed to the true mechanics of how it gets there. So I think if our informational session deals with how your bill is going to be impacted, that's probably going to be more helpful than trying to explain.
Yeah. I wonder if it would be useful, given the impact that the hydro, the renewables are going to have on our bills. I'm wondering if it would be useful for the Energy Board to
I mean, I'm remembering the choices we had a few years back in terms of, you know, going to what was called dubbed clean coal. We had, you know, two contract potential, you know, buy-ins to clean, so-called clean coal, which never ended up being built, and the communities that bought into those projects ended up with these big bills.
Right, they're paying debt service on it.
For the work that was done before anything ever got built, and then it never did get built, and they're still stuck with that bill. But anyway, I'm just wondering if it's useful for the Energy Board to kind of just analyze what has
just
occurred.
Review our
just kind of review
portfolio.
How we came to the place
yeah.
that we came to. And I mean, there's the environmental impacts and the reasons that we did it. But I also think it might be useful so people aren't sort of turned off to the notion that thinking renewables are always a lot more expensive or that was those were bad choices for in terms of for financial or economic reasons. I don't know. There's any interest.
These are two different issues almost.
Yeah, they're very different
issues.
What
we're talking about here is rates that are based on revenue.
I understand that, but it's happening at the
that
same time. It
right.
seems like
and
it's so people are going to even see that much bigger, and it's going to be reported, I'm sure, as it should be, that you know these hydros coming on are going to increase our costs, and it just seems like a little bit of analysis of those decisions might be useful.
Yeah, I think you know I'd be interested, John, as to what you see coming down the pipe with President Obama's climate change. I mean, how do you think that's ever any of that's going to ever be implemented? Do you think the state of Ohio is ever going to get back to Strickland's plan of the 25-25
mm-hmm.
plan? You know, part of what's hurting us right now is that you know when a lot of these decisions were made, some of it was being forced on it. I mean, you know, there was government mandate. And that's just not there anymore. I mean, most of that probably has to do with the natural gas and those prices being so low. But I mean, what do you think about whether Ohio is going to have any mandates for?
I looked at the clock because I want to make sure we had enough time to
yeah.
discuss this. At least the governor has gone on record as saying that he intends to, you know, take action to keep it from continuing to freeze. And I suspect that probably will be the case, but and that's only one piece of the puzzle, though, with regard to how you know all the you know what's going on with the whole clean power plan and whatnot. I mean, I'll just tell you what I think. My gut feel tells me we're going to see coal plants shut down eventually across this country. Maybe not all of them, but certainly probably the worst of them. And unfortunately, those are coal plants that are pretty much been paid for, depreciated. And they're going to get replaced with new generating resources. Now, whether that be renewables or whether it be gas-fired, natural gas-fired, because we are seeing a lot of that going on. But the chances are that the new generation is going to cost more than what the old generation cost, which that means, in general, the price of power, the price of electricity is going to go up in the marketplace. Now, you have hedged that situation because, as we said, you've got a large percentage of your resources already locked up in hydro, that have a lot of fixed costs to them that are not going to be directly impacted by you know the change in the market. And so I think in the long run, I think you're going to look a lot better than probably where the market's going to look someday down the road. Now, how long before we get there? You know, I got 3 or 4 crystal balls in the desk where we can pull out and look at it. But really, I think it's inevitable that we're going to see a change in this country with the use of fossil fuel and particularly coal fire. Generation going forward. We're not going to see new plants built. The one that was referred to as very stable will probably be the last one that we'll probably see come online. Maybe the last one ever, unless we figure out some other way to do it. But again, that's not going to mean that we're going to see lower costs necessarily as a result of that, because all that old infrastructure that we were getting the advantage of it being depreciated and paid off is going to have to get replaced with something newer. Unfortunately.
So any other, while John's here, any other comments or questions? Schedule-wise, I'm thinking maybe if staff can work on putting together some kind of an educational program, but we look at bringing this back. We only have one more meeting in February, so maybe we look at bringing this back for a discussion item in March.
And we'll have two hearing, two readings. So maybe those will either be in March or April. We'll just kind of see how things roll out.
Does anybody have any questions about the hydro as well, John, this year? Projects themselves, okay. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks.
Thanks, Gary.
Pick up my toy before I leave.
Yeah, close. Yeah, that's really small to me. On the screen?
It's because of the PDF, there's not much you can do.
Oh. So, next item on the agenda are council 2016 goals. So, as I said at the last meeting, so the second page is actually the document we had before, although I intended and my intent and what got put out there was two different things. There isn't anything that clearly articulates what's been completed, except for the fact that I took what's been completed off of the 2016 goals. And I apologize for some, I was thinking that the 2015 document had the things that had been completed documented a little bit better than this, so I apologize for that. We've got a color coding system to kind of show whose idea it was. We had a few recommendations from Judith, a few from Mary Ann. There were a few that were crossover between those two, and it seemed that it was easy. You know, I just use another color and combine those because they were so similar. And then I had a few also, and I realize it's hard to differentiate purple from the blue, but.
Karen, I thought what was in italics was what was completed on the 2016 one.
Right, but where did that? I'm not seeing any italics anywhere, at least not what I have printed.
Okay, the one online has it.
Mm-hmm. Oh, interesting. Okay.
It's like the grayish colored one.
Right, well.
Is it italics online?
Yeah, and.
But anyway, I mean, it's at least indicated on the document. On.
Right, it was online. Well, good, that's good to hear. Because I made the mistake of just trying to compress it down to two pages, which was really pretty arbitrary. So, you know, we lost a little bit. This is the old one anyway. So I don't know how we want to go through. If we just want to, you know, I don't know that we need to talk much about the 2015 and the things that were completed. We actually have talked about that a couple of times. So I don't know that we need to talk about that anymore. If we just want to look at 2016 and the new things that have been added, I think what we want to do is decide. And the other thing I did was, unless the goal had been completed completely, I left it on there in the same number order that it was on there before. The three new goals I just put on at the end, didn't give it any number. Didn't give any rating or where it should go in the ranking, and you know, so I think we have to decide: do we want all of these on here? I think it probably ends up being a few more than we had last year, and what order do we want them in? And I think for the new ones, if we do decide we want those, we have a little bit more information to fill out on those. So. You know, I'm open for how we want to go through it. Do we just want to start from the beginning and work through it, or how do we want to do it? Any suggestions?
Yeah, I think we should start at the beginning with this data.
Okay. So the water projects, we just updated to the fact that as far as the plant's concerned, that we're planning on starting construction in July, and then I have the two complete construction documents, negotiate contracts, and manage construction. So that's really, I mean, there could be a lot of other stuff in there, but that's really about the plant itself.
Yeah, but here, I mean, it's a goal that, you know, once we get on contract, then that's completely out of council's control.
Right.
And, you know, I no longer see that as a goal, because it won't be completed till 17. And I mean, it's now become a project.
Right, but in my mind, until it's under contract.
No, that's what I'm saying. I mean, once it's on contract,
right.
Then, you know, I think, and I think, you know, that wellhead protection plan is much more important, you know, because it's been around so long.
Mm-hmm.
And with or without the water plant, if we don't get that done, we're not protecting our water supply. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, Mary Ann and I were talking about this a little bit. Mary Ann was pointing out, actually I should probably let her talk because she's the one that made these comments to me, but you know, some things, our council's going to be doing a lot of work. Some things staff's going to be doing a lot of work. Some things committees, commissions are going to be doing the bulk of the work. So, you know, there's this prioritization of council goals, but with all those variations, I mean, I'm not quite sure what to do with that. I hope you have some thoughts on it, but.
Well, it feels like we should go through, I mean, it feels like before we start to talk about prioritization, maybe we need to at least go through them all. And maybe in this situation, because we are a step farther with the water plant than we were last year, maybe these two need to be separated out. Maybe these should be two separate goals. But, you know, it seems like, you know, kind of let's kind of go through it. I mean, that's why it's always a struggle to do goals, because, you know, we're trying to decide, you know, maybe what we decide is, you know, we don't need to decide absolutely at this point, but maybe start to throw out there, do we think this is a goal for 2016? You know, maybe the water project is, you know, until we have a resolution giving a contract, I mean, we're going to have a number of resolutions, a number of things before that thing gets under construction. At that point, it is out of our hands. But I'd say it's going to be July before it's out of our hands. So I don't see how we cannot have it as a goal for 2016.
Yeah. I mean, I guess I would see continuing to have it as a goal until it's complete, really.
Right.
And you have a time frame there.
And
2018.
So let's maybe kind of put a tentative line, though, at wellhead protection, that we may want to consider that as an independent goal from the water plant.
And I'd like my name to be under people responsible for that.
Well, along with okay, yeah, and
that's
okay.
Mm-hmm.
Sure,
that
has to be
changed.
Yes. Okay, yeah, I got the other, I got Denise out, or I got John out of there, but I forgot Joe. So then the next goal about basically about economic development, I kept the language of the goal the same. I left the update comp land use plan and revised economic sustainability plan because I didn't exactly remember how we ended the discussion, but I thought we were not sure that either of those should be goals necessarily, or should be actions under that goal, because the comp land use plan is really more about planning commission than it is about economic sustainability.
Well, I mean, another option would be to add them to the responsible column.
Right.
I'm not sure I'm ready to just remove it, but whether it's the most important
right,
action.
Right, yeah. You know, what I did add, and these were mine, was to do the work that we've kind of talked to economic sustainability about, and that they're talking about taking up, which is the Economic Development Revolving Loan Fund, incentive policy, property inventory, and how to have a web presence that says more about our business community, and then develop a plan to address business expansion needs. And you know, my idea was there is, you know, to look at developable space. One of the things is to look at developable land and properties to see, do we have a place for businesses to expand or new businesses to locate, and what might be options there.
Yeah, I think those are very good additions.
I had a couple of things that I thought would be good to add under anticipated results. I think supporting existing businesses is as important as looking for new businesses.
Right, yeah.
And then under resources, under that same goal, it seems like community resources should be listed as a resource. Okay.
The next one, develop strategy for fiscal sustainability, sound financial footing, improve. I mean, this one didn't change at all. I think we may have taken a couple of things out of there because they were completed. But I mean, this is honestly one where I don't know.
I think we could illuminate it.
I agree, because I think it what it's really saying now is stuff that we should be doing.
Yes.
Anyways. So. I think we can eliminate that one. Decide strategy for sidewalk repairs and new construction. The only thing I did there was add the fact that we actually know we're going to be doing the streetscape on the west side of Xenia Avenue. You know, we haven't really talked about this specifically for a while. I think we all know how important it is. I think we were pushing it a little bit last year for the possibility that it might be rolled into a levy, and that was decided we weren't going to do it for the existing levy.
The streetscape will be finished on both sides of the street because we remember council decided they wanted to do the part in front of Speedway as well, and potentially the light poles by the hotel, which Johnny has to talk to Mr. Hammond about.
Okay. So, I mean, that I think if everybody's satisfied that we keep that one, I don't know that we need to have much more discussion. The reason I left the passenger property tax levy on there was until it passes, it's going to be a goal. And I think we can take that off. Hopefully we can take that off after March 15th.
What is the, where it says plan for maintaining infrastructure under results? What is that?
I don't know where that came. That was just plan for maintaining. I mean, I guess it was just part of the levy. That's always been part of the levy is maintaining. I mean, a lot of the levy proceeds are used for roads and streets and sidewalks and things. So I think that was the idea. I don't remember. That was from last year.
Because that was when we were also, you know, deciding what those funds were going to, you know, when we were talking about the sidewalk in particular. So I think that's why I got on there.
Over on the other side, involve community in developing a vision with goals for energy use, including citizens, businesses, nonprofits, and village government. The village solar project that is, you know, will be underway this year. I added this explore energy efficiency replacement of lighting in village-owned facilities. I don't know if that's a goal for anybody. I just happen to be aware of a project that's going on with Green County Libraries that I was interested in exploring.
We talked to them, and their proposal wasn't.
Okay, then cost efficient. We can take that off. Sure. Although I would like to say that given what we just heard about our electric rates going up, I still get back to wanting to find some way to put some emphasis on energy efficiency. Mm-hmm. If you know, that's a way for us to be able to offer savings to our customers. You know, their rates might be higher, but if they're able to use less electricity, mm-hmm. Then they may not pay any more monthly. So. That's just something I continue to, you know, look to the Energy Board to consider.
And we have been still working with Efficiency Smart. In fact, I think Little Art is working with them.
Yeah, and that made me wonder, Patty. I mean, is there something along these lines that we can do to help facilitate the use of that program more?
Actually, the Energy Board talked to Carl Andre from Efficiency Smart about that. Last fall, and about ways to advertise the program and how to get the word out to the businesses. They do have regular, the representatives do come to town and make regular business contacts, particularly with businesses. We talked about working with the realtors to get the information out about the appliances that, for your home, whether you're building a new home or you're purchasing an older home and replacing appliances. We're working with the realtors to do that and gave them some of the flyers that they could hand out, so.
Okay, I think that would be great.
Yeah, it is something that the energy board did discuss last fall.
Okay.
Under resources, you could put the Yellow Springs Resilience Network.
What's the difference, what's the Climate Action Planning Group?
The Climate Action Planning Group is part of, it's a village government plan. The Resilience Network is a more broad-based, not only the village government, but businesses.
So, I mean, maybe Resilience Network should replace that, right?
No, I don't think so, because the Climate Action Planning Group is us, is our.
Well, then
it's kind of a combination of Energy Board and Environmental Commission.
And that's, then, I mean, if we're consistent, that's persons responsible versus, I mean, the way we've been looking at resources is what do we have outside?
So the Climate Action Group could be listed
a separate lender.
Where person responsible, okay?
Kim, I know we're trying to move through these quickly, but you would, if I understood you correctly, you said once the levies pass and that's over, passes of the property tax levy. But the financial plan for the future and then planning for the infrastructure passes of the property tax would be one way to accomplish that. But we don't really have a plan for maintaining the infrastructure.
Well,
we do
not so much for streets, but we're working on the what I've asked Johnny and Jason to do together is come up with a list of streets and prioritize them in the order that we want to do like full street reconstructions on. And when I say a full street reconstruction, I'm talking about water infrastructure, sewer infrastructure, stormwater infrastructure, and the whole street, and then also potentially lay fiber optic and electric underground.
And to me, that's your plan for maintaining the infrastructure.
Right,
but like Karen was saying, once we pass the levy, that levy, when we put the levy on, we didn't look at all those.
Right, but I think what Karen was saying was that at that point it kind of becomes like the water plant. Once you sign the contract, it becomes a staff responsibility to develop that to make sure, I think is what.
Well,
unless I'm not understanding.
I'd like it to be on our radar. I mean, one of the things that I made a note about is, based on the article that Ellis submitted that I think Judith asked for, and and Henry Myers mentioned this as well, I would be interested to see, what we are planning for too, for sewer and water lines and things. So I think what Jerry's saying is where does that go then? We don't want that piece to disappear.
Develop a capital improvement plan. I mean, that's really what you're talking about, is developing a capital improvement plan.
Passing the levy is a step in that or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
Well, and I think something we actually did talk with Melissa about that fits into this fiscal sustainability strategy is we have talked about, and I think we may be considering other options for other options of taxation. I mean, and that kind of fits into. Funding the sidewalks. There are other options. She's looked into alternative income tax options with reciprocal. There's fees combination of fees and taxes. So maybe something like that needs to stay.
Then move the passes of the property tax up under the strategy for developing fiscal sustainability.
Yeah.
And then just rename number five.
Well, I mean, I think it's maybe more about, let's see, strategy for fiscal sustainability. I think let's keep that one. Let's add capital improvement plan, activities required, capital improvement plan, and something related to tax.
Okay.
Analyze tax taxation, or add analyze revenue options.
Okay.
Which goal?
Under develop. So we'll keep develop a strategy for fiscal, or maybe the word isn't develop. It's, what is it anymore? It's ongoing. Ongoing.
Review.
Execute a strategy. And
although it's, I mean, to me, it's always going to be changing because, so, I mean, we'll come up with a word, but we'll put capital improvement. I think we can take review budget monthly off. I mean, that's required.
Thank you.
Take that off. That way, but we can use determine best uses for publicly owned property because that is a financial asset we could potentially look at.
Because I don't want that to go away.
Right.
As well.
Capital improvement plan and analyze revenue options or something.
And another piece that we've already accomplished is, you know, we started to set up those capital improvement funds.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I think that was an important step.
So we'll take number five off then. We will take the direct passage of the property tax levy off.
Do you want to put that under
under
number three?
Yeah, we can do that. At least for a while until it passes, yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Number seven, and this may, I don't know if this was actually yours or not, Marianne, but this had been the one about determining a strategy for what green space that we were interested in acquiring. What I decided to keep it in, I took that part out, but I decided to keep in the strategy for funding the green space easements because we don't really have a strategy for where that money is going to come from. And did you say explore options for projects? Is that one of your goals? Was this one in green one of your goals? Explore options?
No.
It's your, then that must be mine. So this is supposed to be mine.
I mean, is that a goal that we have right now? In 2016, does council want to be, or want staff or work with team? Do we want to be looking at more ways of funding green space outside of the village? Do we? I mean, I'm questioning that I'm suggesting maybe it doesn't.
Well,
right.
But that's, I said to expand and enhance village green space. And that's where, the one thing I did, and I hope it's okay with you, I took your glass farm one and divided it up into, I actually put the wetlands restoration under that because I feel like the wetlands restoration is more about green space and it's separate from developing the last farm, I think, because it's already there, first of all. And it's also...
In the past, the village has put money into green space outside the village.
Mm-hmm.
Is that important for us in 2016? And I'm suggesting maybe not.
I think it's one of those things that we don't know, because what if one of the properties, what if a key property becomes available, and Krista's going to come in here and say, this key property is available, how much is the village interested?
So
one of the properties, and that's why just figuring out where the money is going to come from is, I think, something we have to think about.
Well,
isn't the village council already putting a small amount of
a year
into
yeah.
the fund?
Mm-hmm.
So do we want to spend a lot of energy this year, that's the question you're asking, given all the other things that we're thinking about doing, trying to figure out more clearly what our strategy is for funding easements, or do we want to just keep doing that and we're putting that money aside, and if Krista comes before us asking can we use some of that money for this project or that project, we'll just decide that
over
an individual basis.
you know, maybe that's something that we, kind of a direction we give the staff to be thinking about, to Melissa and Patty, to be thinking about, you know, is there a stream or, you know, what would happen if we were asked to come up with.
But I think it would come to council would.
Right, it would determine if it's a priority. So we can remove the determine a strategy.
And it probably means being in touch with the council electorates, I mean, on, you know, on at least quarterly probably, just checking in. And the Council Land Trust is probably going to know as much or more than we do about options for.
I just know, I think my recollection is the last time that she's just, Chris is just in a situation where she just never knows when those properties are gonna break.
But we need to know what impact on purchasing those properties really have on.
Except for the fact that we just decided at the Environmental Commission's recommendation that the priority properties are going to be related to the well field and the wellhead protection plan.
Okay.
So we've identified those priorities. So
Okay, I see that. Because to me, if that property does not protect our well fields,
right.
It was the well field, that was one, and then the next was properties along Dayton, Yellow Springs Road, right on Dayton, Yellow Springs Road.
Then maybe our goal should be protecting our well field.
Well, but it's a question of how much can you do in a year,
and
what are we really going to be doing here? Personally, I'm fine with, you know, when things come up, that they bring it to us and we assess it at the time, and that we don't have to have some system by which we try to figure it out.
Well, and the thing to remember about it is that if we were going to put that money in there and fund it regularly, it would come from the general fund.
Right.
So you can always make a supplemental appropriation out of the general fund to fund a particular project if it comes up in an emergency, correct?
And the other thing, you know, the other thing I've thought is this, you know, if we make a decision to sell village-owned property, should we, you know, target some of that money to green space? You know, I mean, those are the kinds of decisions we can make at the time. We don't have to make a blanket decision.
I don't think we need to try to figure out what our policy is about how we decide this.
And you know, the next one, so there's explore options, and I mean, that was in response, I think, to the wetlands restoration. You know, to me, both of those things are happening. I added this project out here because I just didn't want us to lose it, because it's really two very similar projects with the same funding that the same people are going to be involved in this year, I'm assuming.
Well, the restoration of land behind the Ryan Center is ongoing, and in fact, I'm meeting with Krista and Michelle Wednesday morning about that. So, I mean, that project is actually half done.
Okay. I mean, part of what we've done in the past with these goals is to make sure we don't lose major projects that staff's involved in, so we don't get too excited about a bunch of stuff and then staff's like, we've got all this stuff. I mean, we could take this whole thing off. I think it's all going to happen. Let's leave it for now. So, develop and implement a plan, the fiber optic network. I didn't do anything to change that. I don't know if you want to add anything. I think it's probably farther along. I don't know if we want to change the language in any of that to reflect that.
Okay.
At this point, am I right that work that's being done on that is mostly being done by Rebecca?
Springstead.
Springstead.
Right.
As opposed to council's not really doing anything. And is staff very actively involved?
Yes.
This time? I mean,
Melissa and Johnny have been actively involved, and the community access panel is helping to vet. And in fact, they've asked to do a presentation at our next meeting. So,
who has?
Springstead, which we'll mention later.
So we may not need to change that goal. I think it was on a couple of other people's. Expanding the Parks Department programs to collaborate with community members and organizations to include arts and culture and environmental stewardship. You know, I personally don't see that as a council goal. I see that as a commission goal.
I think it's an oddly worded goal, and I'm wondering if we need it.
It's fine with me to, yeah, okay.
Is that a, it's going away?
Yeah, it sounds like it. I mean, nothing's final right now. And let's go back up to the green space. Do people just want to eliminate that one altogether?
I'm fine with that. I guess the one thing that does occur to me, though, is, you know, it's easy enough to say if something hits that we're going to figure it out. But somewhere there's got to be some kind of long-term planning. But I agree, maybe that's not a priority for right now.
So
I'm okay with that.
And both the wetlands is firmly in the staff and environmental commission control. So really, there won't be any more action by council, or okay? Is that? I mean, I'm asking a question.
Will be some. You'll have to pass the like, for example, there's the beaver management plan and some things that are being proposed that will need to come to council for.
Mm-hmm. Okay,
but right.
But yeah, I mean, there's a lot of other stuff that we're going to have to approve. Okay, so then the next three are all new. Criminal and restorative justice were both on Mary Ann and Judith's list. And then Mary Ann specifically used the words strengthening of mayor's court, which seemed a little more specific, so I kept that in there. Judith added the outcomes, and then each of them had a specific action that would contribute to that. And Judith filled the whole thing out.
I tried to do that, but I wanted to change. I think I want to change. Change it a little bit in the first column, the goal, just to make it criminal justice system review and update, sort of this broad thing. And then under that, the mayor's court and looking at restorative justice, I mean, the way it's written there is fine. Reviewing police policy, make appropriate changes, develop police department policy under enforcement. Then the third column, I was thinking, strengthening the mayor's court is one piece of it, but in terms of that first column, but I thought we should just have that overview. And I talked with Ellis Jacobs about, you know, so how do we, you know, this is something that's been in discussion in the village for well over a year, you know, how to go forward. And we came up with this idea of a citizen task force. The council would develop the charge, create a criminal justice system citizen task force that would be kind of looking at both the mayor's court, restorative justice models, and also looking at police policy. There's a lot of, looks like, very interesting things coming out every day practically in terms of recently there, just in the last couple of days in the New York Times, there was a police chief group that had gone, who are making all these recommendations kind of nationally trying to look at police departments recommending different policy changes. So I was thinking of the task force as doing research, sort of pulling together these ideas then bringing those ideas to council, not that they would make a recommendation exactly, but that they would be bringing, you know, sort of pulling together those ideas, things that are relevant to our community. I'm sure some of it would not be. And also, I know there's, Alice has talked about for some years about restorative justice models, you know, integrating that with the mayor's court. It would strengthen the mayor's court and and then, so.
So do you see both of those? Do you see the one below that, the police policy? Do you see those?
Yeah, I see them together. I see them together.
And Mary Ann, that was your goal. Is that okay with you?
Yes.
Yeah, I thought they. And it also seems like most of the things, actually, the first item under, what is this? Results, the strength of the mayor's court, I mean, that's clearly an outcome. The other two really seem to belong over in the next column. So what I'm thinking is, I'm wondering if the two of you can maybe work on rewording it. And I mean, obviously, people have other comments.
Well, I just had a question. Judith, why wouldn't that task force make recommendations?
Well, I feel like it's such an important issue that sometimes I feel like it's better to have different options brought than it can be discussed, you know, the whole council. It feels to me like this is a new discussion area, and so.
Well, I guess what I'd like
because commissions, I don't think the public generally participate in that fully in those discussions. When you get a recommendation, sometimes you get one recommendation, it's sort of like then, you know, people are kind of trying to convince council of that recommendation. I don't know, I feel like it just leaves the things a little more fluid and open to get the whole public.
Well, I guess one piece that I think of with a recommendation is how do you operationalize it? And that, I guess that would be important to me, is not just a laundry list of ideas, but things that could actually work and some thinking about that. So maybe that is not the same as a recommendation, but that seems important.
So maybe that's part of thinking about the charge to the task force. Mm-hmm. It's not just this broad, bring us 100 ideas.
Because we've already gotten a lot. And, you know, I think now the piece is what can we actually do and is workable. So I would just like that to be in there.
I mean, this is clearly going to be as complex or more than the discussion we had in 2015 about the task force. So, you know, part of what I'm hearing from Judith is that it will be kind of a deliberate discussion, and with, you know, without any necessarily this kind of targeted date where we're going to be done by, you know, it's more about the discussion and the exploration and getting the understanding than having a targeted date for implementing anything.
I mean, I was imagining it would be a couple year discussion. I mean, task force, because it's not necessarily going to go on forever, you know, in terms of some of our commissions, but with the idea that this seems like it could be a fairly in-depth and interesting and useful conversation for the community. So.
One other thing I wanted to point out, just because I was involved at the beginning of all the public forums, is the use of community policing, because it was pointed out that is a sort of term of art that has a negative connotation. So we sort of purposely talked about it as local policing, not to attach.
Yeah, I didn't put community policing.
Yeah, I think
so. You're suggesting
local police.
All right, because several people, you know, sort of brought forward just kind of what that means and
what it can mean.
Yeah, and so.
Okay, well, we can work on going back with something.
Chrissy, do
you
want to
just say, can we put I just was going to say, can we put HRC as part of
as
the people
resource,
that
yeah,
work on those issues?
So those two will be combined. You two will work on that, and then the last is begin decision making toward developing a plan for Glass Farm to include affordable housing. And that was, you know, both Judith and Mary Ann had that. The specific task was Mary Ann's research and development of a comprehensive plan that includes housing that meets village needs in line with environmental sustainability and energy efficiency.
I wondered about changing the wording to the goal being development of a glass farm for housing, including affordable housing. So it's not just beginning something that will take us in 20 years or something like that.
I'd rather it be developing, at least acknowledging that we have to have a plan.
Developing a plan. Okay.
Yeah.
That's going to be a lengthy process.
So
developing a plan for housing for Glass Farm?
Developing a plan for Glass Farm to include affordable housing.
Well, I think Judith wants it to say for housing to include affordable housing.
Oh, okay.
And also, Mary Ann, when I've heard you talk about sort of the importance of public input into this process, I think it would be nice to have that broken out a little bit more clearly, and just kind of the steps part. I mean, it obviously could be implied in review and develop, but I really thought that was compelling. So, you know, kind of that charrette idea or whatever.
I would be happy to work on this a little more broadly have any input from council, other council members. But I see this as a pretty complex process, because on the one hand, we definitely want to have the community involved. And I think we want to have pretty high goals for it. And we don't have, we have resources, but we don't have tons of them. We don't have money, like, for example, Antioch College to do all this charrette, so. Mm-hmm. So I think it'll take some time to think of how to develop a process and what information we want to have, we need even maybe before we start.
As I'm looking at goal number six, the one about energy use, since we're talking about the resilience network, I'm wondering if we could make that a little bit, instead of just about energy use, make that a little bit more about environmental sustainability.
So then we should put the Environmental Commission in there too. Karen, would you, or I should say, I would like to talk with you more to flesh out this about the Glass Farm.
Okay. So, we've added some verbiage. Let's you know, do we want to talk about the order at this point, or do we want to save that?
Oh, I was just going to say maybe HRC would be a good resource for affordable housing discussions as well.
Yes. Yeah, I mean, and we haven't even gotten to that.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that all needs to be fleshed out. So do we want to try to order them tonight?
I'm really looking at number six, if we say involved community in the development of the vision, and then we turn right back around and say including citizens, business, throughout the community.
Yeah.
Maybe we could eliminate those last.
Just
involve community in the vision with goals.
Yeah.
For village energy use and environmental sustainability.
Yeah. So, do we want to assign numbers, or do we just want to do these updates for the next meeting and then? So we'll do that for the next meeting. We'll be these.
And I feel like this is a manageable and important set of goals. I'm not sure how much I care about prioritization. So,
I don't disagree.
It's just, you know,
I mean, but at some point,
together,
right.
Something has to be first, and it's, you know, there's going to be a perception one way or the other.
Yeah, I mean, I think originally I had said we should just focus on a few goals, but then as I started thinking about it, realizing that we have these different groups. I mean, we have staff, we have council, we have commissions all working, and so it's not being aggravated by my thinking.
Well, again, I think I'd like to say the same disclaimer I think I said last year at this time, that remember that staff is on all of these, so we will have to prioritize our time at some point. So council tends to have competing goals, so please understand when we're trying to concentrate on one thing and can't get to everything right away.
And I think that's been one of the reasons for the idea of manageable, a manageable list was out of respect for staff.
So maybe we need to make sure that council and, I mean, that, well, council staff and commissions are letting everyone know, hey, we have too much on our plate for this time or whatever.
Well, and, you know, related to commissions, I mean, this should be the month to kind of solidify what those goals are, and now that this is shaping up, to, you know, have those be in line with each other.
Anything else? Okay, next is social media policy discussion, and we started that last week. Brian has been working on that, so we'll let Brian lead that discussion.
Okay, well, I don't know if we want to jump into, I was tasked with creating a village Facebook page, which I have a template, so I don't know if we want to look at that, or...
Can we plug it in?
Oh, will it reach all the way down here?
No, we'll see. Okay, he's bringing this...
I can bring it over there.
I do want to point out that it still has that word that Chris didn't like.
Well, that's an old, there wasn't...
It was on the same...
I don't think it was even in the packet, that document.
It was up on the screen a minute ago.
I don't think it was, I mean, it's not in my packet.
It was in the packet that came out on Friday.
Well, that document wasn't revised, but if you look at the Facebook page, it reflects different language. So I think we, and I don't know, what was that word? It was restrictions. I think if you look at what's pinned to the top, it talks about the guidelines. What's that? This is on Facebook right now. So, I mean, I don't know if anybody's found it and been able to like it, but it's secret. So, if you look at this, what is tagged to the top are our guidelines, and then it denotes... Judy, do you want to just read what that intro line says?
Under Village of Yellow Springs?
Where it talks about the guidelines.
Content part?
Yeah.
Yeah, it says your comments may be removed from this page if they do not follow these guidelines. Comments not topically related.
Oh, we don't have to read all those. But yes, yeah, so Chris pointed out that we shouldn't say restrictions, so we changed up the guidelines. But also from reading the article that Karen put into the packet, it seemed that it was important to make it clear that these are reasons why a comment could be deleted. So that was clarified. So, you know, one way that we could do this is we could keep those standards always pinned to the top. And then I just put a couple sample posts up if we scroll down, so to kind of show some of the things that I think we were talking about. So what is that? So that's our, you know, our link to the council meeting, the last council meeting, and also letting people know that they can go to our YouTube page. I guess after that, something about the art cans, you know, just always like highlighting the cool projects that we're doing. I think below that is about the meter change out. So, you know, obviously having these sort of alerts and things. And I don't know if I picked the best pictures or whatever, but that's kind of the upshot.
Thank you.
Yeah, I mean,
but we haven't approved it. We haven't approved the policy, and we haven't approved it to really launch.
But is this what the purpose is?
Well, it's ready to launch.
I mean, it's launched. If somebody knew what it was, if somebody looked it up, what is the tag that you put in to get it?
Well, so right now, probably if you search for Village of Yellow Springs, you could find it.
That's what I did, but I'm not picking up what you've got.
it was a local business, Village of Yellow Springs, but not the local government.
That's on there.
You found it?
Yeah, I mean, technically, I didn't make a nice link, Village of Yellow Springs yet, because you actually have to have 25 likes before that happens. So right now, it's just like a random link. So, but we can customize the link to whatever we want. But yeah, but the idea was that this wasn't really supposed to be public, but just a, you know, for us to look at and see.
So what do we need to do?
Well, I mean, I think we want to talk about, do we want it to be static, or do we want it to be, do we want people to be able to comment? And I know that at the last meeting, I was supportive of having people comment, and I'm having maybe potentially second thoughts about that. So I think that's something to talk about. And then what?
Why were you thinking it would be a good idea?
Why would it be a good idea? Just, I was thinking, you know, I probably the same thing Brian was about, a little bit something a little bit more interactive. I think one of the things that Brian talked about last time was the possibility of putting community events on it. I think that this page has to be absolutely limited to village government. So, you know, I think the art cans work. Because that is a public utility, that they are public functions. But the public art that's on our property, I think would work. But to show pictures of a bunch of art, I don't think that's really within the realm of what we're doing.
And actually, Judy, if you go to the about, there's a short statement. You have to click on it from the top. There's a short statement that talks about the purpose of the page, which was language that Patty suggested, which is basically to share activities, and I can't remember what it all says.
Yeah, it says inform community members about village events and activities and provide important updates.
So I agree that we need to stick with that. You know, that focus. This is not just a everything about Yellow Springs page. We already have Yellow Springs, Ohio, which does a great job with that. This would, you know, again, we had talked about, Judith, at the last meeting, that all the commissions that have events can funnel them through here. But, you know, what's interesting about the comments thing is, actually, the recommendation from Community Access Panel was to start without them, to cut them off. But we did have a discussion that Kettering, for example, and Judy and I went to a workshop about this. They let people make comments. They don't perceive it as any problem. And, you know, a lot of municipalities look at it as another way to, you know, get feedback. Some people are more comfortable with that forum. But it is important that we have what I call objective standards, you know, again, like, we're not going to accept profanity. So if you drop the F-bomb, we will delete that comment. If you were
so
posting
it. So who's actually doing the deleting?
That's the other thing then that we need to, I think, firm up. You know, our initial thought was we've got some village staff members that would be administrators. So, you know, Ruth Ann's been very involved in the website, as have Patty, Melissa, Judy. You know, obviously we need to be careful about anything we would delete, you know, as far as comments go. But, you know, we have to be able to justify it with those standards.
When you say we got to be careful about what we delete, and whose website is it?
Well, I mean, it's ours. We just have to, you know, it has to be clear that it violated.
As a public entity, Jerry, if we are going to allow comment and somebody posts something, we have to be careful that it violates the guidelines that we've posted, so that we do not get accused of simply deleting it because we disagree with it or something like that.
Does there need to be something like if there's comments about an individual?
I think that's where it gets sticky. That's where it gets really sticky.
Well, I guess
it's not profanity, but it's other kinds of remarks.
Right, and, you know, because y'all's friends people speak out.
Well, but you know, if you, if the article that Karen shared with us, I mean, we can make those standards that you can't call your boss, you know, an a-hole or whatever, but the reality is that courts have said that you can. So, you know, there's a limit to, you know, what we can restrict. I mean, that's certainly true. But to me, the best example is the chief has a Facebook page that's been functioning for at least 6 months, maybe longer, and I have yet to have seen any comment that was, you know, of a nature that it would be problematic. So I think that's pretty notable in and of itself, that it's all been what I would consider constructive feedback.
But I'm not thinking so much about us as, you know, other members of the community, as it might be said. I don't know.
Well, and I, you know, there have been comments put on other Facebook pages that have been critical of staff, that it's, you know, it's not always fun. You know, I mean, is that, and we wouldn't be able to take those off. I mean, those would clearly not be able to be removed.
Could we? And this is a question, I don't know the answer, so I'm asking, could we not put under the guidelines derogatory comments about any individual?
Well, the problem that you run into is you have to kind of do it on a case-by-case basis. There's not a blanket rule, you have to look at the context of what's been done. One of the things that I believe other communities do is that you can push content. And by pushing content, you also push less desirable comments to the bottom that become harder to find. I mean, certainly it would be, you would want a legitimate nature to push that, legitimate reasons to push that content. But there's plenty of things to keep the community informed about. So I think, from my perspective, the village is not the first community to do this. Many others have done it. I looked at Kettering's policy. I liked Kettering's. I like Cleveland's. They're long. And this has been pointed out, the chief doesn't seem to be having a problem. The PD doesn't have a problem. I come back to this. I think that while there are a few people out there that probably have abused the privilege of speech on occasion, or the protection of speech, but let's just see what happens. You know, we can adapt to it. Yeah. I think that the council has kind of made a determination that you want to go forward with the project. Let's not stop it because we get bogged down in this in what the policy ought to be. We can figure that out because we have the ability to be flexible and adapt. But I would expect the first time there's some questionable post that I'm going to get a phone call from Patty and we're going to have to talk about it. And that's just the reality.
What do we want to do tonight? I mean, what are we tasked to do tonight? Clearly this thing exists, so people are going to start to try to find it. So we're either going to have to tell Brian to take it down, or we're going to have to make some kind of decision as to whether we support what he's done.
Can I say something real fast?
Sure.
I'm all for the website, if there's no comments. This is an announcement. The way I look at it is for water main break, for electric outages, for building updates and stuff like that, to get it out to the public. I was originally doing that, and I put on a peak shaving for the village, for Patty and myself, and I mean, it just went crazy.
You put
a peak shaving from AMP to tell people how to save power and cover peaks down. After that, I never posted again on any Yellow Springs website. I'll post it on mine. Other people in the village like it. If this thing has comments, me as a staff member, I will not use it. Because I'm doing it as a service to the village to help out. I don't need the comments back.
They're,
the rude comments, the derogatory comments, were falsely accusing, and this is a help for the community. It's not something to start a link to figure out why we're doing what we're doing. It's just to get the voice out there. So if there's comments added, me as a staff member, I won't use them. So that's my two cents.
Abby, thank you.
Well, I mean, Johnny has a valid point in that anytime someone from, everybody sitting here pretty much knows, I don't go to a lot of the Yellow Springs websites.
Facebook pages.
I mean, because...
Well, you mean, what we're talking about now, though, is discussion groups,
right,
not Facebook pages.
And so...
So there is a difference in,
right,
the two.
And I do see this more as an informational thing. I share some of Johnny's concerns about the possibility of it becoming derogatory. I think I'm of a mind that as long as Chris says we have the ability to be flexible, I'm okay with the comments unless they become derogatory. I think Chief has not really had any derogatory comments on his. So, you know, I think that it would be a useful tool to staff. I understand what Johnny's saying. I really do, because they have gotten pretty vicious at times. But.
And those were posted on what are intended to be information. And bulletin,
right,
board is not a discussion board.
Right.
It's a discussion group. Sure it is.
But it's more informational. So
I mean, I think a lot of things get out of control there as well as on others. So I don't know. I mean, I guess I make the point, but remember, you know, the recommendation I brought forward was community access panel saying no comments. But I do think it's interesting that, you know, again, if there were going to be derogatory comments, they would have been on the PD Facebook page.
Not necessarily. People may not feel very free making derogatory comments.
And then, but I think... I think that's about understanding the purpose. I don't think it's about people being afraid, but you know, maybe I'm wrong. I think.
Well, why don't we do this? Your recommendation and what whoever it was said, let's put it up with no comments at first and get information out, and let's see what the public has to say. People are kind of thinking, let's talk about that, and then as the same thing.
Well,
but I'd like to see it get out and at least start pushing stuff out and then see what we go from there.
Well, and I would be comfortable with that, Jerry. It's, you know, no comments at first, and maybe, you know, as long as everything's going. You know, quite frankly, there are numerous ways to contact me or any other staff member if you have a complaint about something. So, you know, the only... I don't know. I'm torn because would I necessarily care if the comments were positive? No, but if you allow comments, you can't make sure they're going to be positive. And it is very demoralizing for staff when people make the negative comments. And most of the time it's because they don't have all of the information for the situation, but that doesn't help because they've made the comment. So.
Except, and then here's why I'm torn. But I'm pretty ambivalent, is that this is now this is our page.
Ooh.
You know, we can address those things and clarify them.
Except
and answer
which council
questions.
Member is which council member's perspective is that going to be? I mean, I think it real, you know, what if a staff member ups the ante? You know, I mean, I think it's
you know, I can't have my staff responding to those things. So,
right.
You know, but at the same time...
So it just hangs out there.
Right.
I mean, you know very well on some of those, there is no winning.
Right.
There is no winning in a response. And if you say anything, it just ups the ante and it just inflames. And then it just keeps going. You know,
And quite frankly, I tend to have a thicker hide than most of my staff members, and that's not just Johnny, but I tend to have a thicker hide. But I see
when the EPA calls you the next day after a post goes on,
about water quality, yeah.
That's a problem. I mean, that's my license. So it is a problem, and that's why I won't use it.
Yeah.
So, I mean, personally, as a way of people giving us input, I don't go on Facebook. I don't even know how. I'm kind of old fashioned that way. But from what I hear, it sounds like it's often not very productive, the kind of discourse that goes on in those. And so maybe that's not the point of this, you know, but people are used to doing that, and there's all that anti-government, you know, there's a lot of people who, you know, flood government for a lot of problems, and so. I don't know. I have a thick skin too, so I'm not actually worried about us as much as I'm worried about its citizens if it starts to be used as a venue through which comments about other citizens, which I would be concerned about that.
And I think my thought on that is there are numerous ways to contact the village. If you have an issue that you want to resolve, you can email us. I mean, I get 100 emails a day.
And let's just, with every post, let's have there be a contact person. Chances are it's probably going to be Ruthann.
Ruthann or Judy or myself.
So, but with every post, let's make sure there is a follow-up. If you have any questions, if you have any concerns, either with an email or a phone number.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, I think I agree with Jerry. I would be in favor of maybe no comments right now and just see how it goes, but have a contact person who shows. That's a good idea.
And that's
and I think that's what Cap recommended in the first place, right?
That was the recommendation that was brought up.
I think you probably should at this point.
Yeah. So
let's do it.
What does the policy say? I mean, can we just vote on the policy, or?
Well, I think at this point, we're not worried about the policy.
Okay.
We accept, you know, we maybe need to come back to what, be more specific about what can go on here. But maybe what we're voting on now is to
restrict comment.
But to officially launch the Facebook page.
So a motion this is going to be one.
To launch the Facebook page as has been presented by Brian, with no comments allowed, and I would say that the content will be of village government, interest, business, emergencies, whatever. But it has to be directly related to village government.
Okay. And,
second. That was a motion, wasn't it?
Yeah. Yeah. Anything else? Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay.
All right, so Johnny, you're the first admin after me. Because now you can use it because there's no comments. Right?
We added commission nominations, so I'll turn that over to Brian. I think you saw a number of resumes on your desk. I don't know if everybody's had a chance to
Let's start with Brittany Baum. So Brittany Baum is a new resident to town. She is she's a graphic designer and artist, and also a small business owner. And Karen and I interviewed her actually today. We do have a spot on the Arts and Culture Commission. I was very excited about her skill set and the fact that somebody new to town wants to get involved. So I'd like to recommend her for the ACC.
Okay. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
and next we have three applicants for the Economic Sustainability Commission. In talking to, we have two full seats and two alternates. After talking to Emily Seibel, Emily Seibel, I corrected myself quickly, and Adam Abraham, and also Allison Moody, we actually talked about the fact that Adam does have a permanent seat on the Planning Commission. So he was happy with an alternate seat, and I think he brings a diverse perspective, so I'd like to have him there as well. What I'd like to recommend is Allison Moody and Emily Seibel for the two open seats, and Adam as the alternate.
Okay, and...
Second, I have a motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
No, I ask that.
Oh, sorry.
Yes, I mean, so what is our makeup now? We have diversity within the community.
Yeah,
we have diversity within backgrounds, because I don't want to see it out being one-sided.
So I think, what's nice about Emily and Allison is, besides Karen as the alternate, we now have two women members. Emily also, brings the homing, affordable housing piece, and so she's already working a lot on economic development, and that's a big background of hers. Allison Moody, one thing that's interesting about her is that her family owns a major development company in Dayton, so they really understand that piece. And of course, Adam brings a variety of different pieces. So, with these new additions, I think we have a really diverse group. And a group that I think is going to get some stuff done. I mean, it was neat in the first meeting to see how much expertise there was in the room. Good question.
So we have a motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Did anybody second you?
Yeah.
I did. And then there's one more, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Isn't there somebody for environmental?
Yes. We have not had a chance to
interview.
Oh, okay. Okay, so we'll hold that one for the next meeting. I guess we have staff reports next. Patty?
Okay, we pretty much went over the first one, which has to do with the AMP Hydro going online and the meeting that Johnny and I attended. So there is an article that Karen was able to find that she forwarded to us for your packets about the Hydro projects. It was from the Plain Dealer, and it should be in your packet. The installation of the new electric meters is continuing. When Joe Bates was here, he was in several publications, and when I got the catalog for this year, lo and behold, I opened it, and there was our own Johnny Burns with a quote in the AMP training catalog for 2016. So we have a new celebrity.
What's even more significant is without a hat.
It's off the website. This is his website picture. I knew as soon as I saw it that was his website picture. We now have a new celebrity, and he will be available to sign autographs.
The plaque is in the mail.
Yeah, the plaque is in the mail. We had the second coffee with a cop. It was early in the morning. It was not quite as well attended.
I went to all three, though.
God love you. And there should be some pictures in your packets that go along with that. The water plant process is ongoing. Can't really say too much more than that. We have another meeting with Shook this week. In your package, you will find a support letter from AMP regarding tax-exempt municipal bonds. This is being circulated by the National Association of State Treasurers. Apparently, one of the things that has come up in the federal budget talks in the last couple of years is making what are currently tax-exempt municipal bonds no longer tax-exempt. And that is not a good thing for municipalities who are trying to do infrastructure projects that are funded through tax-exempt bonds, and so they are asking the support and letter of support and signature of a representative of council on this letter to go to Congress so that we could kind of head that off, try to head that off. So if council wants to do that, I would think that you would have to ask Karen to sign that letter on behalf of council.
So it would basically, it's this letter,
it is.
And at some point, somehow, they're just going to probably say Village of Yellow Springs, Karen Wintrow, mm-hmm.
Right, yeah.
Village of Yellow Springs.
Yeah, we can retype it if you are so inclined, and you will put a signature line on it. And
well, it says, I would read this, it says that they just want to know.
Yeah.
If you plan to sign on, so I would just let them know. I mean,
yeah.
Council, are you in agreement?
Yeah.
Okay. Just let them know and have them tell us what we need to do.
They might want an electronic signature.
Yeah.
Okay, we're hoping to have the second annual village employee soup and chili cook-off, and we had suggested the 19th, but Ryan is not available on the 19th. So is everyone available on February 26th?
No.
Okay, so Karen is no on the 12th and the 26th.
And is this during the day? I forget.
It's at lunchtime. Everybody comes in and we just all eat soup for lunch.
I mean, it doesn't, everything.
Would a Wednesday be better?
Or a Monday, or would I have Sunday to cook?
Oh, yeah, a Monday.
Monday's always better.
Okay, so the 19th is a Friday, so the 22nd? Monday the 22nd?
I'm not going to be here.
Or the Monday before that, right?
That's President's Day.
Okay, that's right.
So Judith, you're not here on the 22nd?
29th is
the day. And I'd be gone. I'm still on vacation.
Anybody have any suggestions?
29th?
I'm gone. I mean, we're not going to get it for everybody.
Friday, March 4th.
I'll be here.
I'm good.
That's okay for me.
Okay.
Friday, March 4th it is.
She.
Okay. So Friday, March 4th at noon, we will have the cook-off. We'll let staff know, and council gets to be the judges again. In an effort to get a little bit healthier, our staff is participating in a weight loss challenge. Today was weigh-in day. Melissa Godlover is heading that up for us. You pay $10, and we're trying to lose weight for a month. And at the end of the month, the person who's lost the largest percentage of body weight gets the money.
2 months. We extended it out.
Oh, did we?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. 2 months.
There you go. The last thing I have is in response to Ellis's concern about the lead, potential lead in the system. I did speak with Brad Alt, who is our water treatment operator, and Johnny is our water distribution operator. And I have here, it should be in your packets, a little write-up from Brad about that. And I'll just go ahead and read it because it's kind of short. Yellow Springs Water Treatment Plant is required by the Ohio EPA to test lead and copper from the same 20 sites every 3 years between the months of June and September. The 20 sample sites are all residential homes spread throughout town and have been approved by the Ohio EPA. The OEPA monitors these test results very closely. All sample residences receive a lead consumer notice within 30 days of receipt of the results, as well as verification submitted to the Ohio EPA within 90 days from the end of the monitoring period. Additionally, the village has to submit these forms within 10 days of the EPA or the end of the monitoring period. The OEPA monitors lead by the 90th percentile, and it has to be under a 0.015 milligrams per liter or 15 UGLs, which is parts per billion. The village's 90th percentile in 2007 was 5.02. Okay, so it has to be no higher than 15. Ours was 5.02 in 07. In 2010, it was less than 5. And in 2013, it was 11.3. But the reason that it was 11.3 was because there was one anomalous test that they retested immediately, and it was a false high. It was, when they retested it, it was down to the regular range, but it was too late to submit it as part of the test results for that year. So it was immediately retested. It was found to be a false high. The village will be testing for lead and copper between June and September of this year. This is the year that we test. And then Brad does give a little explanation. In 2013, one resident showed higher than normal levels of lead. There are many factors that could have influenced this result, such as, but not limited to, sampler error, lab error, or sample contamination. The sample site was retested immediately after prior results were received, and lead levels were shown to be normal. Although these levels now show to be normal, they were processed outside of reporting dates and could not be repeated. One of the other questions that that Ellis had was the prevalence of lead pipes in the village, and that's why Johnny has hung around for so long. The only lead that we can find in the pipes in the village, or has been found, are these really strange little connector pipes that reduce a 4-inch pipe to a 2-inch pipe. Am I saying that correctly?
That's correct.
And they're about, what, this long?
Oh, no, they're about that tall.
Are they? Okay. Can't really tell from the picture.
Right.
And so, Johnny, do you want to explain? And we do have a picture if you really want to see it. Judy's got it up on your screen.
Oh, I was surprised at Judy when I found it, because we have a leak in Dalston. And after digging down, we found this. The four small pipes attached to a 4-inch pipe, which all go into what we call as a turkey foot, and then it reduces to a 2-inch. To my knowledge, any place we'd have a 2-inch, you're going to find this.
So which are you saying is the lead? The larger piece, or those small?
The lead would be
1-inch pipes.
This is copper. Then you got the ball, and then it's lead to the next ball.
So it's those little
ones. So you have about, I'm going to say, probably 8 to 10 feet of lead pipe right there.
And why does that look? I mean, is that just corroded? Is that?
That's actually just corroded out of the ground. And actually, what was leaking was the lead. We actually temporarily fixed it by taking ball peen hammers and beat the lid back around until we get the part to fix it.
So,
to my knowledge, and I can only go by what we've found so far, any place that you have a 2-inch main, we will find this same apparatus.
And is this on village property? Is this part of the village distribution?
Yes.
Now,
that was on Dalston Street.
But we don't have many 2-inch mains.
We have 22 of them.
And that, but how many linear feet ballpark?
I couldn't tell you that. These are at the intersection. Now, from what I gathered from the previous superintendent, at the other end of Dalston, they had already removed the one. So you would have one at each end to make the loop system.
Okay, so if we have 22 of those, then that would leave 21 of them. So potentially we have 42 of these.
Correct.
And you said 8 to 10 feet on each turkey foot?
On each turkey foot.
But these are in the distribution system, so if it were in fact leaking into the water, it would show up in the samples.
Correct. Absolutely.
And you are replaced, so now that you know this,
that's
are you
done.
Replacing
that's replaced.
This? One? Okay.
It's already been replaced. We replaced it with a different coupler into the 4-inch main, and it went from plastic to galvanized.
And is there any way that we can potentially look at these 20 sample sites, and if we know where these lines are, maybe make sure we at least have a couple of homes?
Yes.
I mean, is that static? I'm assuming that's been static, and that's part of it.
Yeah.
To get a year-to-year.
Once the EPA approves the sites remain the same so that they get the same data,
right,
and compare apples to apples. But
we have no records of where these are at. This was found on a 4-inch to a 2-inch, and unless we dug up every intersection that had
can we go get tests from that neighborhood?
We actually had to test the water sample for this road when we turned it back on, and we had 10 samples, and they all come back good water.
I think part of what Ellis was just asking, and I think he just wanted to be sure, it's because of is that when the water is being softened, and so the pH changes, is there any danger at that time that there would be corrosion, and not just in our system, but in old houses that have lead pipes?
We're making a softer, we're not softening
so.
He just thought maybe we should ask the.
Yeah, I don't think that.
Yeah, we can certainly do that when we talk, get into that full design of the plant. That's not a problem. I think what you need to remember is so many people here soften in their homes anyway. So they're probably already softening. So I would say that if someone is softening their water currently and they're concerned about that, they might want to get a lead test kit themselves. Or they can maybe call a lab. I don't know if a lab will even take a private sample, but I would assume they would. But so many people here soften at their home, you know, from their basement.
Yeah, but a lot of people don't.
So what is coming out of our system, we test, and when Johnny charges a new line, he has to test that. And we don't know that out of those remaining 21 lines, some of them haven't already been replaced. I mean, they could have been.
And to go back to the very beginning when you talked about you're asking staff to notate the critical stuff.
Right.
All the 2 inches are on my list. We knocked 3 off since in the last 2 years, so.
So that's not the only one you replaced?
2 inch lines, we've canceled 3 since I've been here. We had 25 2
inch lines. Oh, yeah, okay, we had 25. So,
it's just to note if people should be, I mean, maybe if it's not something to worry about,
right,
then to ask people to test their water.
Right.
But if it's something that, you know, the softening that's going to take place, I know they're not installed,
right,
could affect it, people should know that so that they could be cognizant.
Right, and we would certainly, number one, speak to the engineer about that, and number two, continue the test as required. And if we do soften, I'm sure the EPA will be on top of us to make sure we do that. So.
Okay.
Thank you. That's all
I
have.
Thanks, Johnny. You can go home now.
I'm going.
Assistant Village Manager report.
The only thing that I have is that the telephone payment system is operational now. There is a telephone number that's in the packet. It's 1-877-885-7969. It's accessible 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and they are only closed on Thanksgiving and Christmas Day. So customers can pay their bills with Visa, MasterCard, or Discover. American Express is not accepted over the phone, but it is still through our online system. And the good thing about the telephone payment system is that they are able to process checks over the phone. We're not able to do that online, but we can do that over the telephone. And the fees are very similar as the credit card fees associated with paying in person and paying online. They are 2.75%, and if it's below $100, there's an additional fee of 50 cents. If it's over $100, then there's no additional fee of 50 cents applied. And check fees are flat $1 per transaction. So that's up and running, and yeah. And the financial statements are complete. I'm still entering them into the auditors, the state auditor's website. And our audit crew has already contacted me requesting a report, so that's starting up. So that's it for me.
Judy?
Just very pleased to say that the hiring committee for the clerk's assistant has offered the job to Kathy Gudgel, who has accepted it. So as soon as her background check comes back squeaky clean, as I'm sure it will, she will begin. And thanks to the Wright State intern, who's helping a lot get us ready for audit.
Very good, thank you. Excited for you to have your new staff member. Let's see, we have no executive session, future agenda items. Will we have the OWDA?
We'll just leave it
there. We'll take it off if it's not. Council goals resolution, what I'm thinking is that if we'll go ahead and have Judy write the resolution, and we'll have the goals updated. If we feel like we're ready to adopt it or to pass it, we will. If we don't, we won't. Glen annexation.
Chris, have you heard anything more from?
I have not.
They had to take their plat back because the auditor's office requested some additional information on it.
Okay.
So apparently they're not quite ready yet.
Okay, so we have, and so it may or may not be there. We, it sounds like it probably won't.
I would say no.
And then we have three commission reports. So I guess I'm sure we still have a couple more. It looks like we have the Energy Board Planning Commission on March 7th. So how many more, how many are scheduled? Clearly, we won't have an economic sustainability one this year, an annual report, obviously.
Or two reports.
Yeah, so have you heard anything, Judy, from?
No, I'll just slot in some.
Yeah, just slot in.
What's going to happen?
But yeah, so we've got arts and culture, we've got HRC.
HRC is next time.
Oh, is that already on?
Yeah, that's
okay, it. Sorry.
There's a total of 7 now, and that should be.
And the mediation program is going to be scheduled at some point, right?
Yeah, it's already in there, March 21st.
Yeah, you want to put CAP on March 21st? Since they're coming, are they coming to the next meeting, Brian, you said?
So that is not CAP, but that is, I guess, one of the things, right, that we need to, so their request is for the meeting on the 16th, the Tuesday meeting, since it's President's Day on the 15th. They're asking for 10 to 15 minutes.
And at this point, it's not looking like a huge agenda. So how does council feel about the SpringNet reporting out on the...
A fiber optic network for the village of Yellow Springs is the topic.
On the 21st?
On the 16th of February is what they're asking.
And do they have a goal of what are they, do they, are they asking us, are they asking something of us?
They have a white paper and they have the financials, so they're going to present that and discuss it briefly.
Okay. Okay, we'll just see. So we'll say 10 to 15 minutes. And that's the only other thing I would say for all of us on our commission reports, to just, are you talking to the commissions about 5 minutes?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I actually said to the SpringNet folks, you're looking at probably more like 8 to 12, because you want to leave some time for questions.
Right, okay. And then we did say that on March 7th, we're looking at possibly, we'll tentatively put legislation for electric rate increase.
And did you want that discussion? Did you want staff to bring back discussion points?
Well, I guess, yeah, we talked about maybe the legislation on the 21st,
right.
And then we'll have discussion on the 7th. Okay. Anything else? At this point, doesn't seem like anything else from staff that you see coming forward. I mean, at some point, I'm assuming we might have something to do regarding the water plant in here.
I hope to have a report for council on the 16th,
okay.
But I won't know that for sure until after
okay.
the meeting on Thursday.
Okay, sounds good. Motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you all.